and they're going to be in good shape. But I feel like West Virginia's defense is going to play strong football early, and we're going to have to spread. If the Pitt unit will spread, have to go in motion, use single back offense with a lot of wide receivers to get the Pitt aggressiveness to match the aggressiveness that you know will occur with the defensive front of West Virginia.
Panthers will get the football, and they've got a change on the kickoff team, and that is Michael Hadley back deep to receive. Keith Tinsley had been doing that going back to last year, but Panthers just kind of shaking things up a little bit, see what they can get going. Tinsley will be playing wide receiver this afternoon instead of defensive back. So Michael Hadley's back awaiting the kickoff at the goal line, flanked up to his left by Nate Hayward and to his right by Doug Hetzler. And we'll be ready for action in just a moment as the ball is placed on the tee by the West Virginia place kicker at the 35-yard line to our right and across the field. He's on the right hash mark. The place kicker is Robert Woods. Charlie Bauman is expected to see some action as a placement kicker this afternoon, but on the kickoffs, Woods is going to handle the chore to start the game. The foot's through the ball, and the ball's in the air. It's a short kickoff. And Nate Hayward takes it back at his own 15, up to the 20. Loose football. Panthers have it. Hetzler falling forward across the 25 to the 27-yard line. Nate Hayward went into a pile at about the 25. The ball popped loose and sat on the carpet in open field. Hetzler alertly picked it up and fell on it. Fell forward with the football to the 27. And that's where the Panthers start first and 10 at their own 27-yard line. You don't like to see a football game open in that fashion.
That's a big break for Pitt because that ball could very easily have been recovered by West Virginia and should have been.
John Kingemi, the Panther quarterback, steps in under center. Wing back to the left is in motion. That's Billy Osborne. Panthers overload the right side with receivers. Osborne will receive the pass at the 26. Loose football. West Virginia has it at the 28-yard line. Osborne was hit and hit hard, and the fumble recovered by Brad Hunt. Hitting Osborne very quickly as he received that pass across the field was strong safety Larry Holley. And West Virginia's in business. First and 10 at the Pitt 28-yard line. The Panthers on two successive plays have committed two fumbles. West Virginia gets this one.
Handle the ball twice, fumble twice. This could be a long afternoon if it continues.
West Virginia first and 10 at the Pitt 28-yard line following the fumble recovery. And now referee John Sophie of the Collegiate Independence is going to stop things. It gives us time to give you the officials today. The umpire, Edward Kukert, the head linesman, William Cronin, the line judge, Gerald Height, the side judge, George Cullen, the field judge is Joseph Dorenzo, the back judge, Albert Ferber, and the clock operator at Pitt Stadium, Dan Martino. West Virginia now ready to go first and 10 at their own 28. Mike Kimko gives it off to the right side. John Hollyfield, short yardage, gets one, that's about all. He's tackled immediately by Jerry Olsavsky. Panther middle linebacker, the sophomore from Youngstown, Cheney. And the ball is no gain to the 28, and that's where it is spotted. So the Panthers defensively have done the job on the first down. Let's see what West Virginia decides to do with a second and 10 at the 28. Alvin Phillips and Grantis Bell are the receivers to both sides. Out of the eye operates Timko, the junior quarterback. And the give is to Hollyfield. He tries to turn the corner right side. Gets to the 26-yard line. That's about all. Tackled there by Walter Johnson and Jerry Olsavsky. The Panther blue-shirted defenders had the play figured out. And when Hollyfield bounced it outside, he did manage a couple of yards into the 26. It'll be third down and 8.
That's a pre-call. That bounce out when he runs in the line of scrimmage and dips it outside is a play designed to do just that.
Harvey Smith and Alvin Phillips line up to the wide side, the left side of the field. West Virginia third and 8 at the Pitt 26. Timko back, short pocket pass, and it will be dropped at the 20-yard line. Harvey Smith had the ball underthrown toward the sideline. He had to come back too far for it. Even if he catches the ball, it really would have been a gain to the 20, which would have been short of the stick. So West Virginia on fourth down and 8, line of scrimmage of Pitt 26, has the field goal team on. Charlie Bauman, after suffering with a sore leg and missing a couple of games, is back in there. The right-footed soccer style kicker from Erie will be trying out of the hold by Timko. A 43-yard field goal for West Virginia. The attempt on an angle right to left. Ball's on the tee. Bauman's kick. It's long enough. It is high enough, and the kick is good. West Virginia gets on the board and leads it 3-0. There's a break in the first quarter action. We'll be right back.
Power close out.
43-yard field goal by Charlie Bauman has West Virginia on the board with a 3-0 lead, 13:36 left of the first quarter. The Panthers put the egg on the carpet, and West Virginia gets three on the board.
When you fumble in that location, even though West Virginia did not make a first down, they were in field goal range immediately. So Pitt has got to hold on to the ball, get out of the danger territory, and if you're going to continue these mistakes, at least to continue them on the other side of the field. West Virginia did a fine job of taking advantage of that fumble to put three on the board.
Ringgold High School's Larry Holly made the big hit on Billy Osborne that caused him to cough the football up. Brad Hunt fell on it. West Virginia's offense was stymied, but they got three as Bauman kicks the 43-yard field goal. That was an important element in West Virginia's offense that was lacking for a couple of games. And, of course, against Maryland last week, it came right to the surface and hurt the Mountaineers. Now let's see if the Panthers can recover. Remember last week, Pitt fell behind 14-0 to the Purdue Boilermakers. I get the feeling they don't want to do that here today.
I don't think they can afford to, and I believe that this will be the test. They got to get the ball into their territory in this series of downs.
Here comes Woods' kickoff. It'll be taken by Hadley at his own eight. Up the left side to the 15, the 20, finds a hole at the 25, and will be hit and knocked down at the 28-yard line. The ball is loose, and they call it down on impact. It is down on impact. It is Pitt's ball.
That could have been called either way, in my estimation. I really feel like he might have fumbled it before. I don't know. I don't have a replay or I can't see it, but it was a close call, and they cannot continue to handle the ball three times and drop it three times. That's Pitt's average right now.
Panthers started first and 10 on the 27 in their first series. Now their second series, exactly the same spot. Wide side of the field to the right. Billy Osborne is a wide out that way. Backs are split behind Kingemi. Pitt first and 10 and its own 27. Kingemi, the senior, takes on the counterplay. Craig Hayward up the right side. Good block. Knocks over a man and gets out to the 34-yard line. Craig Hayward with about 7 yards off that right side. Found a hole, went through it, then tried to dip it outside and was tackled on the play by Preston Waters, a defensive back from Miami for the West Virginia Mountaineers. Line of scrimmage, the 34, after Craig Hayward's 7-yard gain. It'll be second down and 3 for the Panthers at their own 34-yard line. Hayward starting at tailback in place of Charles Gladman. He won the job, at least to start. Panthers with a single setback on second and 3. Kajemi back to pass. The pass will be thrown complete to Billy Osborne. He's at the 40, the 35, the 30, the 25, the 20. Osborne on his way up the left sideline, going all the way, beating Lockwood and Holly for the Panther touchdown. Billy Osborne got open. West Virginia's defense completely fooled, and Osborne takes it. 66 yards for the score.
Unbelievable comment. What they have to do there, they broke Osborne across the seam, and he lost his man in the crossing route. In doing so, perfect lead by Kingemi. And even though he didn't have much speed, and he's not supposed to, I guess when you have the ball under your arms and you're scared enough, you can run.
Well, he ran scared, and he ran effectively. And when he got open, it was just a foot race. Lockwood and Holly were too far behind. Osborne, 66-yarder. And here comes the extra point try. It is knuckled up there by Jeff Van Horn, but it is good. And the Panthers have the lead 7-3, 12:42 remaining first quarter. There's a break in the action. We'll be right back. To try to get you relaxed after two successive fumbles is probably nothing like a 66-yard touchdown pass on the second play from scrimmage.
You know, you hate to see it, but sometimes that happens, Bill. Here's a West Virginia High from recovering a fumble and going in and scoring, and they become complacent. Not only they, everybody does, and the other team comes out all shook up and drenin', and we got to get it back, and it happens quick.
Osborne lined up as a flanker to the right, and then on next thing you know, on second and 3, he was running up the left hash mark. It's a crossing route, obviously. Did West Virginia get caught with a man who didn't cover, or was it zone coverage?
They had zone coverage, but they ran a man deep through the secondary and drew his man out of the area. Once he did, Osborne ran into the open area and outran him. That surprises me as much as the fact that it went so far.
Billy Osborne, former quarterback, defensive back, now a wideout, a fine athlete from Wildwood Crest, New Jersey. And one of the Panther leaders, by the way, especially on offense. You've got some quiet people over there, John Kingemi, Randy Dixon. They don't have much to say. But Osborne is a spokesman, and he made up for a fumble that gave West Virginia 3 points and a lead that was very temporary. Less than a minute later, the Panthers are back on the board with a 7-3 lead. Mark Brasco will kick off the football as he places the ball on the tee between the hash marks on the 35-yard line to our left. West Virginia has its return game deployed. And back at the goal line is Darren Fulton, a wide receiver, 5'7". He's fleet, and he can bust him long. has a 51-yard kickoff return to his credit so far this year. So the Panthers are going to have to get their alleys filled and get the coverage for the West Virginia kickoff return group. Here comes Mark Brasco approaching the football. It's in the air. The kick will be high, not particularly long. Fulton waits and takes it his own 8. Up the middle behind the wedge at 10, the 15, through the hole at the 20, and he's out across the 30-yard line before he's tripped up and tackled at about the 32-yard line.
Now, that's good return blocking. They had a double wedge front, and Pitt was worried about this all week. The kid's a good returner, but that wedge was devastating. West Virginia came up there shoulder to shoulder, and one of the Pitt men came in and had to take it out. Good return. They're in good field position.
Cardinal Smith making the trip tackle on Fulton at the 31-yard line of West Virginia. Wide side of the field to the left. Twin receivers out that way are Harvey Smith of Gateway High and Alvin Phillips. Timko giving to the deep back on the first down carry. John Hollyfield, short yardage out to about the 34. Falling forward to about the 34-yard line. He was tripped up by Walter Johnson, the Panther defensive tackle, and pinned by starting linebacker Darrell Woods on the weak side, the 6'3", 210-pound sophomore from Newark, New Jersey, the younger brother of Tony Woods. So the line of scrimmage after the 3-yard gain is a 34. It's second down and 7. West Virginia trailing this contest 7-3, 12:08 first quarter. Mike Timko at 6'2", 194 pounds is in there. Rolling left, looking, firing for the near sideline, incomplete. He really didn't get a good release on the ball. Alvin Phillips, the intended receiver, had broken underneath the coverage of Gary Richard, the Panther cornerback, to the right side. But in trying to run left, that's the hardest pass in football to deliver, and he just misfired.
Yeah, he misfired because he did have the corner beat. West Virginia hooked the defensive end of Pitt. He rolled and was open, and so was the receiver. However, as you had said, it's difficult to throw that pass, and the ball was low and short, and they couldn't make it complete.
Grandis Bell and Harvey Smith are the twin wideouts to the wide side, the left. West Virginia third and 7 from its own 34. Rolling left, being chased. He throws a pass too tall for the intended receiver, John Hollyfield, out of the backfield. Hollyfield had gotten open coming out of that backfield, but the Panther pressure was too much from crashing ends Tony Woods and Burt Grossman. And again, Timko misfires, and the West Virginia punt team is on the field. Billy Osborne will be back as the deep return man for Pitt. Lance Carrion is the punter from Valley High School. Carrion averaging over 40 yards per punt so far this year. And the deep snapper is John Stroya, a sophomore from Canton. Snap is true, big rush, and Carrion gets it away and sends a long spiral downfield. Osborne takes it, he fumbles and has to dive on it back at his own 17-yard line. Billy Osborne back there because of his sure hands. Didn't come up with the sure hands on that try and was fortunate to get back to it and lose the 2 yards to the 17 where Pitt will have a first and 10.
They're going to have to get that corrected. They can't help that. It seems like, Bill, they're changing their deep receivers. They changed the deep receiver on the kickoff return from Tinsley to Hadley, and he fumbles the ball. Now, Osborne is back there. Obviously, Austin cannot be back there, and that's the problem they're having now with the new people in the ballgame returning these kicks.
47-yard punt by Lance Carrion, younger brother of Kurt Carrion, a former Mountaineer punter. Osborne in motion, Pitt first and 10 from his own 17. The give is to Ironhead Hayward, and Ironhead is tackled as he crosses the 20 and plunges to the 22-yard line for about 5. Inside linebacker Darnell Warren, a freshman from McKeesport High at 6 feet tall, 236, made the tackle on the play. West Virginia with 2 starters on defense from the tri-state area and about 5 starters on offense from the tri-state area. So there are a lot of strong feelings back and forth. Good rivalry game. Pitt now after the 5-yard gain to the 22 by Ironhead. Second down and 5. Osborne from his wing back left spot in motion through the formation. Kajemi straight back. 3-man rush by West Virginia. Pass over the middle is complete. And we've got a flag in the backfield as there's a late hit on John Kajemi. The pass complete to Hosea Hurd for the first down out to the 30-yard line. And they'll be tacking on 15 more for the late hit for roughing the passer. Getting in there and upset with himself is one of the defensive front people for the West Virginia Mountaineers, and that would be David Grant, the middle guard. He got in there and hit Kajemi. No, it's not Grant, it's Jeff Lucas who got in there and hit Kajemi late.
Now, in that series, they're using the Oklahoma defense, 5-man line with 3 men up front. They suddenly dropped the defensive ends. They went to a 3-man rush and tried to control the passing game with 5 underneath. Obviously, it didn't work, but they only broke loose with the nose guard who came in late and hit on Kajemi, but they went to a 3-man line with the ends dropping in the last series.
Personal fouls marched out to the 38-yard line where Pitt has a first and 10 following the roughing the passer call against the Mountaineers. Pull back Tom Brown in motion to the right. Jimmy back. Sets, plants, fires, the pass is incomplete, almost intercepted. Out of the hands of Darren Gillespie, the intended receiver. Larry Hawley, the strong safety, tried to grab it, but dropped it. That'll be second down and 10.
They're using coverages, Bill. They're not using pass rush. Again, three-man line with five underneath people. Then they go to the zone in the deep three. So it seems like their game plan now is allow them to throw and try to get into the zone.
One. It'll be third down 11. The Panthers leading 7-3 with the first quarter at 10 minutes and 30 seconds as the clock turns. We've got Vernon Kirk lined up as a wideout. Tight end from Ringgold. He's out to the right. Darren Gillespie flat to the left. Double wing and a single setback. Reverse motion by Tinsley, who's in there for the Panthers. And Kajemi's back. Screen pass Tinsley drops it out at the 34-yard line. He had gotten out behind the Panther blocker there. That is Bill Chirpak. And he dropped the football. And the Panthers will have to punt.
Tinsley, they're relying on his speed. If he had caught that ball, he had two men in front of him. However, West Virginia did a fine man with a three-man rush stop at the series before. I was impressed.
Here's the snap to punter John Rass. Not much of a rush, and he kicks it into the wind. And it's not particularly long. Harvey Smith will take it his own 26. Looking for the wall outside to the left. The Panthers. Down he goes at the 24-yard line. Making the tackle and forcing it from the outside were several Panthers, but Zeke Gatson is a man who got to him. Panther linebacker on special teams making a fine play. West Virginia puts it in play, first and 10. We'll be right back. By freshman punter John Rasp of the Panthers, and West Virginia has a first and 10 at their own 23-yard line. The Mountaineers beginning their third possession of the football game. West Virginia has not made a first down as yet, and the Panthers have one first down. That was on Hosea Hurd's reception and the ensuing 15-yard penalty for West Virginia for the late hit on John Kajemi. And so the Panthers, if they are not guilty of fumbling the football away, would have a 7-0 lead, but credit West Virginia. They turned the Panther turnover into 3 points on Bauman's 43-yard field goal. But right away, within a minute, Panthers came right back strong. Kajemi to Osborne, 66 yards for the score and the lead. Twin receivers, Smith and Phillips, out to the right side, the wide side, and Timko rolls that way on first down. He's going to fire it and open, but incomplete. Calvin Phillips had gotten open under the Panther deep coverage and was just at the 45-yard line all by himself, but Timko misfired again. He must be getting heat from the Panther ends.
Yes, he was. I thought the ball might have been tipped. It looked like Tony got up there, Woods, and tipped the ball. I'm not sure, but it took off after he had thrown it, and they're getting a lot of rush on the receivers, you quite well noticed.
Twin receivers to the right, Grandis Bell and Harvey Smith. West Virginia second and 10 from their own 23. Draw play with the football is the fullback, and that is Chris Pecan. And Pecan is snuffed out and dropped at the 25 after a 2-yard gain by Lorenzo Freeman, the Panthers starting defensive right tackle at 6'5", 255, the senior from East Camden, New Jersey. Lorenzo playing a fine senior season. And I'm sure he's got the attention of the pro scouts.
He sure has. He did a fine job. It looks like West Virginia is going to go with an action pass game, because everything they do, they fake a pass after the handoff. So you're going to see a lot of bootlegs and action passing.
Harvey Smith and Gary Basil are the receivers up top to the right, to wide side. And on third and 8, Timko's back. Pass over the middle, intercepted. The Panthers have it. Billy Owens at the 35, the 30, the 25, the 20, and he's knocked out of bounds at the 21-yard line by John Holyfield. What a play by Billy Owens, who just gets better and better with each passing game. Owens with his fourth interception of the year, and the Panthers in business at the West Virginia 21.
That's when I said they were going to throw action pass. What they do, they go to two backs, drop straight back, and try to read coverages. Obviously, the young man is better at, Timko is better at throwing the ball from action, because on that drop back series, he threw the ball right into the hands of the Pitt defensive back.
Let's pause 10 seconds for station identification on the Panthers Football Network.
Westinghouse, 120,000 employees around the world, dedicated to quality and excellence. 1250 WTAE, Pittsburgh.
Pitt first and 10 at the 20-yard line. Give to Charles Gladman. He tries the left side, but the West Virginia defense is there. Gladman gained only a yard trying to sweep it to the left side. Tackle on the play for West Virginia and their white-shirted defense. is put on Gladman, who gets up slowly, along with the man who was at the bottom of the pile, inside linebacker Eric Lester, a sophomore from Cleveland. Panthers gain barely a yard to the 19. It'll be second down and 9.
The Panthers are going to have to control the linebackers. West Virginia linebackers are now moving up tighter than they were in the first few series.
Vernon Kirk, a wide out to the right. Inside him in the slot is Hosea Hurd. Panthers have a wide out split to the left side. Now the wing back left is Tinsley. Reverse motion to the left side, the short side. Kenjemi takes and he's back. Plants, pumps once, fires for the end zone. Wide open, Hosea Hurd for the Panther touchdown. Kenjemi to Hurd. Hurd, his first career touchdown, beat Preston Waters, the cornerback, and was wide open in the end zone. The Panthers lead it 13-3.
They lost the man. It was not the coverage. They had that pump fake, drew everybody to one person, and suddenly he comes wide open because, look, they lose the man and could not see where he had gone because of the pump fake.
Kenjemi will hold the extra point try by freshman Jeff Van Horn of Cheney, Washington. The ball is on the tee. Van Horn kicks another knuckleball, but it's up and good. I mean, he's kicking the ball dead in the middle, folks. We understand that free safety Bo Orlando of Berwick, PA, is out of the ball game now, has a sprained ankle that's been x-rayed, and that's why Waters was in there, and that Waters was the guy that Hosea Hurd beat very badly. Matter of fact, how many times in the end zone do you see an offensive player, a receiver, be able to turn his back to the goalpost and wait for the ball?
Yeah, that was that's tough on the young man, but when Kenjemi made the pump fake, he drew everybody to the tight end that he pump faked to, and he broke open into the end zone, and Hurd was able to throw it in there without any trouble.
Panthers another two-play drive, this one covering 20 yards. And the capper, the 19-yard pass from Kenjemi to Hurd. Kenjemi's second touchdown pass of the afternoon, his fourth of the season, and the Panthers lead it 14-3 with 8:22 left first quarter.
They're going to, I would think, right now, West Virginia is going to have to go back to the pass action game. But understand, if they get behind any more, that is not a strong suit to try to catch up with, because who cares if you're faking a run and throwing the ball?
Across the way, Don Nealon has his staff on the field gathered around with his kick return unit. Nealon in his seventh year at West Virginia, where his overall record coming into this game, 50 wins, 23 defeats, one loss, and overall in 16 years as a college head coach, 103 victories, 58 defeats, and five ties. And he is now 8 wins away from tying Pappy Lewis as West Virginia's all-time leading coach in the victory department. And Lewis did it in 10 years. Nealon's only in his seventh season.
See if Brasco can get the ball a little deeper this time, because he put that ball perfectly as far as West Virginia was concerned. They were able to form that wedge, and it looked devastating coming up that field.
Mark Brasco will kick it off left to right. Brasco opened the season as a Panthers starting place kicker, then missed 3 field goals against Maryland and promptly was replaced by Jeff Van Horn. And last week, Van Horn responding with a big 47-yard field goal that gave Pitt the 17-14 lead and ignited the spark that sent them on their way to the 15-point victory. Greetings around the Panther Network, around the great state of Pennsylvania, up in Everett on WSKE, in Harrisburg on WHP, and in Johnstown on WJAC. It's good to have you aboard. Here comes Brasco's kickoff, Pitt leading 14-3. Darren Fulton is deep. This will be a short, high kickoff. Fulton comes up to meet it at his own 13 behind the wedge at the 20. He's hit and dropped shy of the 25-yard line. Panthers that time did a good job of surrounding the football. Chris Ross, the defensive back, the sophomore from Ambridge, Pennsylvania, making the play for the Panthers on special teams. West Virginia, first and 10 from their own 24-yard line.
That's one time when the kick, because it was not too far, didn't allow the wedge to form, so the Pitt defenders, as they came down under the kickoff, surrounded and went behind the wedge and was able to make the tackle.
Now, when the wedge has to wait like that,
the
timing's just not there. You can see it. Receivers to both sides for West Virginia. The Mountaineers operate out of the eye, trailing 14-3. Play action fake. Tim Kobach firing the pass downfield. It will be into and out of the hands of the intended receiver, Calvin Phillips. It broke and open out near the 47-yard line. Gary Richard, the cornerback, had help that time in coverage from Troy Washington, but the pass, again, just slightly tall, would have been a great catch, but he couldn't hold on.
That's right, but the young man was open. It was a good route, and he had beaten the Pitt defender. However, as you said, catch had been able to hold on.
Grantis Bell and Harvey Smith are both in there now. Harvey Smith lines up to the left and Bell to the right. West Virginia will go with split backs on a second and 10 at their own 24. Trailing 14-3. Draw play and through the hole in a big fashion is Chris Pecan. The fullback gets out to the 30. He's got a first down to the 35, falling to the 37-yard line. The draw play that time fooled the Panthers, and Chris Pecan, the senior from Laurel Highlands High, got a big gainer and West Virginia's first down of the football game.
It looks like when they go to the split backs now, they're either going to throw drop back passes and controlled curl routes, and they're going to run the draw to the weak side of the formation. They ran the draw, good blocking, and an excellent run for West Virginia on the last series.
13-yard pickup and a first down for West Virginia on the draw play. Now the fullback goes in motion. That's Harvey Smith from out of the backfield, an eye stack setup. And the give is through the hole to Hollyfield, and he steps out of a tackle, gets to the 40, knocked out of bounds on the near side of the field as he gets close to first down yardage, out to the 46-yard line. John Hollyfield trying to bounce it outside, is finally tackled and driven out of bounds in front of the pit bench on the near side of the field by Steve Apke, the senior tri-captain from Cincinnati Moeller.
But they didn't try to trap it. All he did was, as you said, bounce out. He tried to go over the middle. It was clogged, and he ran outside of what we call the free arm. The defensive tackle had his free arm tucked in and couldn't get it into the hole.
9 yards for Hollyfield in the pickup. Second down, one, West Virginia at its own 46, trailing 14-3. They go with the I stack, and this time Grannis Bell as the deep back goes in motion. Play action fake. Timko has time. Now he's going to throw the home run ball. Way downfield. It will be incomplete. I think the Panther defender got a hand on it before it came in for Calvin Phillips. Gary Richard got a hand up and broke the pass up. It was a home run ball. And now we got a marker down at about the 39-yard line in pit territory. And let's see what they decide here. The Panther defense may be guilty of an infraction. Referee John Sophie is discussing it with his crew of collegiate independent officials. And here's the signal from Sophie. It is holding against the defense. That's an automatic first down. The Panthers guilty of holding up a West Virginia receiver.
It was in the short zone, so it really wasn't necessary to do that because they threw deep and threw too high. However, the man that they held might have been the man that was open. You never know that.
For the first time this afternoon, the ball is in pit territory. West Virginia has a first and 10 on the defensive holding call at the pit 44-yard line. Panthers leading 14-3. Two John Kangemi touchdown passes of 66 yards to Billy Osborne and 19 yards to Hosea Hurd. West Virginia, first and 10 out of the eye. Two receivers to the right. The give is to Hollyfield. He threw a hole. Good yardage into the 40, into the 35. Tackled just short of the sticks by Panther cornerback Gary Richard. West Virginia's offensive line with Brashears High, Milton Redwine, the starting left defensive tackle, Kevin Koken of Cardinal Mooney, the center, Bob Kovac of Newcastle, the right guard, and Brian Smiter of the Pittsburgh City League, Alderdice High, doing a good job of blowing the Panthers out up front on that play. Second down and one. West Virginia at the pit 36-yard line. We'll call it second and a short two. The spin and the give is to Hollyfield, and he is nailed as he gets to the 35-yard line to the 34. Very close to first down yardage. It all depends on where they spot it. Good, solid tackle by John Carter of the Panthers. Carter at 6'5", 250, the junior from Angie, Louisiana. Had help from Lorenzo Freeman and Walter Johnson.
It'll be a first down.
Close enough for measurement, and that's what they're going to do here. 6:43 left first quarter. Pitt leads it 14-3, but West Virginia on the march, hoping to get now their third first down of the football game and the third of this series.
West Virginia's offense is starting to go to that fake action series, and it's confusing the defensive front.
I think they're taking advantage of the fact that the Panthers are teeing off and trying to get to Timko also, and so now they're taking advantage of it. It is short of first down yardage by about half the length of the football, inches away, so we'll call it third and inches. West Virginia at the pit 34-yard line. And they make a couple of changes. Wide receiver Grannis Bell is out. Into the lineup is Calvin Phillips, who's joined there by Harvey Smith, but they'll be deployed in tight for the most part. Timko sets him up in a power eye formation on third and inches at the pit 34-yard line. Motion out of that is wide receiver Harvey Smith, comes right out of the backfield. Timko on the keeper has the first down as he just sails behind the block of Kevin Koken and finds a crack and falls forward to the 31 for 3 yards and a West Virginia first down. Steve Apke pinned him down, but the first down was rung up by that point. 6:32, clock turns first quarter, 14-3, the Panthers have the lead. West Virginia started this drive after the kickoff return back at their own 23-yard line. Back at their own 24, I'm sorry.
The West Virginia running game has perked up quite a bit here in this series of downs.
First and 10 at the pit 32, out of the eye. Timko, play action fake. He plants. Now he's going to run out of there along the 40-yard line. Look, he's going to duck the rush. He throws a pass. It's complete out of the backfield, but the man is the fullback, Pecan, and he's tackled by John Carter after a gain of about 2 yards to the 29. John Carter was on the case, and Timko was almost sacked. As it was, he was hit hard by Walter Johnson and Lorenzo Freeman, but he wisely dumped the ball to his fullback waiting to let off some of the steam.
Timko.
We call that a 3 yard gain to the 29-yard line. Second down, we'll call it 7.
Excellent job by Timko, Bill. He was able to scramble out of there and prevent a loss by dumping the ball off.
Turned it into a 3 yard gain. Calvin Phillips split to one side, Grantis Bell to the other. West Virginia second and 7 at the Pitt 29. Draw play. With the football, Pecan, and he's got good yardage. Fights his way in across the 25, close to first down yardage. A marker down back at the 32. Let's await the call from referee John Sophie. Tackle that time was put on him by Troy Washington, the Panther free safety. Pecan showing good aggressive running ability on that draw play. Now the call is. What is the call? John Sophie? He stopped the clock. Now he says apparently the flag was thrown inadvertently. They're going to eat the flag, no flag. And so the gain stands into the 22-yard line.
I'm not going to say anything.
Don't you like to read your name in the papers?
No, they. I guess that's what they call good officiating right there. But
official timeout, measurement.
How do you drop a flag unless you're blowing your nose?
First down for West Virginia by the nose of the football. At the 22-yard line of Pitt. Chris Pecan, good hard running, has West Virginia in position now to get some points on the board with a first and 10 at the Pitt 22-yard line. West Virginia has done it with the running game. After coming out and trying to throw the ball without success against the Panthers, they crank up the run game. They stack the eye, and breaking the stack is Harvey Smith, the wide receiver. Now the give is through there to Holyfield, and he knifes his way in across the 20 to about the 17-yard line. Tackled there by Jerry Olsavsky of the Panthers. Panther middle linebacker from Youngstown Cheney.
They're attacking the seams. By that, the back is going up, finding daylight, and able to gain more yardage than normal because the linebackers of Pitt are dropping because of the action pass threat. So they have them a little confused right now. West Virginia's doing a good job with their action pass threat and throw.
Receivers to both sides. That's Smith and Bell. And the deep give off the left side. Holyfield, what a tackle on him by Jerry Olsavsky. The ball is loose. Whistle on the play, and Pitt has the football on the fumble. A great play by Jerry Olsavsky, who hit the back before he got the head of steam. And when Olsavsky hit him, by the time he got airborne and started back down, the ball had popped loose, and the Panthers recovered. And I believe Walter Johnson gets credit for the fumble recovery.
Really a good effort. Now that time the linebacker Olsavsky, instead of being back into coverage, come up and attacked the play and made a great hit that caused the fumble.
They're saying now that Tony Woods recovered the fumble. That is the official word from the press box, so we'll go with that. But the Panthers on the fumble by Holyfield on a great tackle by Jerry Olsavsky come up with a football, first and 10. The give is to Tommy Brown, and Tommy Brown's going to get short yardage. He probably from the 15 gained 2 or 3 yards before Eric Lester got his legs and tripped him up at the 17-yard line. It's a gain of 2. It'll be second down and 8. The Panthers at their own 17 with a 14-3 lead, 4:08 left first quarter.
They went to the draw series. Looks like they want to give West Virginia a little bit of what they had happened to them, but West Virginia closed that draw play up quite quickly. Therefore, now I believe you'll find a fake draw and they'll throw the ball.
Panthers changing receivers. Osborne's out of there, so is Hurd. Michael Stewart's in there. Single setback, so there are four receivers, two to each side. Gladman in motion gets the pitch back to the right side from his wing bat spot. Tries up the short side, and he is hit and drops a football at the 18-yard line, but they say impact caused the fumble. And we've had a series of loose footballs in this football game. Mike Godfrey just took his, not Mike Godfrey, it was, we got an injured player. And who is hurt? For the Panthers, there's somebody down at the 17-yard line.
Ray Reitner.
An injured player for Pitt at the 17-yard line.
Ray Reitner, go to the press box. Meet John Sumner, please.
Vernon Kirk, the tight end from Ringgold, is the injured player. West Virginia trailing 14-3. The Panthers that time from the wingback left spot tried a little pitch back to the short side to Gladman. And he was upended hard. The ball popped loose, but that was on impact. In the meantime, from behind, Vernon Kirk got a hit, and he is down at the 18-yard line.
Vernon Kirk was at the point of attack and trying to block or feather the defensive end of West Virginia, and I think the guy rolled up on him. He'll be all right.
Now, he's walking very well, just a little wobbly, so he may have got a real bad hit that time. University of Pittsburgh retains all rights of ownership, distribution, and use of any and all reproductions of game broadcast by WTAE. Any recording or pre-production, distribution, or use at any time in any way, commercial or otherwise, of all or any portion of the live recorded broadcast by WTAE or its network affiliates is expressly prohibited without prior written consent from the Department of Athletics, University of Pittsburgh. Panthers with motion by Hurd, facing a third down and long. And the pass is complete, and West Virginia tackles the Panther back in the backfield. That is Tom Brown at the 14-yard line, and it'll be punt formation. Robert Pickett, the outside linebacker from Miami, Florida, with a heads-up play. West Virginia's defense does the job, and John Rasp is on to punt. Fourth down, we'll call it 11 to go from the 14. Rasp has time, hits a poor punt. It's end over end. Coming up to get it in Pitt territory on the fair catch at the 43-yard line is Harvey Smith. So West Virginia will have excellent field position, first and 10 in Pitt territory, to start this drive as they trail the Panthers 14-3 in the first quarter with 2:47 left. The punt by Rasp traveled only 31 yards.
Interesting that last week with those punts blocked, you'd think that West Virginia would have geared up to come after the punt. And both times that Pitt has punted today, West Virginia has been in a hold late return and gave no pressure to the kicker at all, but he still kicked it poorly.
They might be saving that for later in the football game. Twin receivers to the right side, wing back right. Timko's going to roll that way. Has time, pumps once, fires, the pass will be popped out of there, incomplete at the 20-yard line. On his back was a receiver, Harvey Smith. He claims he caught the football. It popped up in the air, but the official on the play said no catch. The ball skipped, hit the turf. Coverage by Quentin Jones, a Panther left cornerback. It'll be second down and 10.
There went to the action pass again. The man he threw it to was not open, but there was a man wide open in the flat, and I'm sure that the West Virginia coaches upstairs are going to call that down and try to get a flood zone in.
I believe West Virginia has one completed pass in the football game so far. That was for 3 yards to Pecan. Everything else has been a misfire, and there was one intercepted.
That make you nervous.
Second and 10. And the give to Holyfield off the left side. Gets a block, but a Panther comes up to meet him for virtually no gain on the play. Driving Holyfield out of bounds on the near side of the field is cornerback Quentin Jones, who did a real good job that time of coming up in run support. West Virginia trailing 14-3. We're in the first quarter with 2:26 left, and the Mountaineers face a third down and about 10. Third, and we'll call it 10, at the 43-yard line of Pitt.
That was a called play. That is, they run in there and bounce the ball outside. That's the only way they seem to have to get outside, to bounce out.
Smith and Bell, twin right outs to the right. Play action fake, Timko rolls right. Steps up inside. The pass will be incomplete. A fine defensive play for Tony Woods. He was all over the quarterback, Mike Timko. The intended receiver didn't have a chance because by the time Woods had gotten there, Timko unloading the ball just threw it right into the turf, and the West Virginia punt team is on. Lance Kerrion takes the field, and the Panthers send Billy Osborne back as the deep return man.
Now, they threw the man I said was open the last time, so they did call it down. However, Pitt made an adjustment also, and the man was not open this time.
Let's see if Kerrion tries to coffin corner this one. Snap is true. He has time. Panthers don't put much of a rush up, and he angles the ball toward the near sideline. Fair catch called for by Billy Osborne, and he takes it at the 13-yard line, and that's where the Panthers have it first and 10. Pitt losing 1 yard on the exchange. Panthers again in action next week, and it's a night game here at Pitt Stadium. Pitt against Temple. Hope we have equally good weather, because today right now the sun is starting to break through, and for those fans in the stands, and they're crammed in at 56,500, a sellout. It's going to get pretty warm if that sun stays out very long.
It's an exciting game. They're seeing a lot of action on both sides of the football.
Too many loose footballs for my blood.
If you're a Pitt fan, right.
First and 10, the Panthers from their own 14. Can Jimmy back to throw on first down. Arches a pass downfield, too far for Billy Osborne. The same type of pass that worked for the 66-yard touchdown. This time, Lockwood and Holly had better, deeper coverage on Osborne. He had a chance to catch the ball if it's not overthrown, and it's incomplete. It'll be second down and 10. He had gotten open enough to catch the ball, put it that way.
Yeah, right. They didn't have a pump fake in there, so the three deep backs of West Virginia were able to settle into deep zones and double cover anybody that came into the deep middle. They were throwing the ball behind the linebackers that time, and now if they throw, I feel you'll find it thrown into the curl area.
Osborne's out. Tinsley's in as a wideout. Pitt with two wideouts on each side of the football. Single setback. Now Hurd as a wing back goes in motion to the wide side, the left. Kajemi back on the right hash mark. Plants, pumps once. Fires a pass complete. Oh, and the pass is caught and then dropped incomplete, they say. Robert Pickett hit Keith Tinsley as he came across the middle. I mean, he hit him a shot. Tinsley didn't hold on to the football, but the official on the play said the ball is incomplete. It'll be third down and 10.
Lucky Tinsley held onto his head. He was hit. That was a great hit by the defense of West Virginia, and the young man wasn't able to hold on to the ball. I don't know who could have on that one.
Scales and Osborne, two wideouts coming into the Panther attack now, along with Charles Gladman. Kirk comes to the near sideline. He's okay, and Michael Stewart comes out of there. So Pitt now with a third and 10 at its own 14. 2 minutes, 1 second left of the first quarter. Pitt has the back split wide behind Kenjemi. Pitt with a 14-3 lead. In motion, Ironhead Hayward out to the left. Kenjemi back, being chased, runs to the right. Fires a pass on the run, and it's complete out near the 28-yard line. And the Panthers have a first down at the 28. Fine grab by Hosea Hurd coming to the near sideline in front of the Pitt bench. Stacy Smith covering behind him could do nothing but knock him out of bounds. But that was after the catch and after the first down is rung up.
Give the credit to Kenjemi because the nose guard beat the center of Pitt completely. Just used the swat and swim, drove around the outside, put pressure on Kenjemi. Kenjemi rolled and was able to hit the wide man for the first down.
That's aptly named, the swim technique, is it not?
Yes, it is. He swam his arm up over the top and made the good rush.
14-yard gain, Kenjemi to Hurd. Hurd's second reception of the afternoon. Panthers now with a first and 10 at their own 28. Go to the running game. Tommy Brown breaks through a hole off the right side, gets a fine block from Ironhead Hayward, and gets out to the 35-yard line before he's driven out of bounds by Pat Marlatt, a sophomore defensive tackle from Princeton, New Jersey for West Virginia. Ironhead threw the block that made that play work.
Yes, and they double-teamed that nose guard. I'll tell you what, the nose guard for West Virginia is doing a fine job, Grant, and he's causing problems in there. And at that time, the reason they moved the ball, they double-teamed Grant and were able to run off the block because he's causing havoc in the middle of that line.
Grant is only a junior, and he's listed as an All-America candidate by West Virginia. Fine player at 280 pounds, 6'4", a junior from Belleville, New Jersey. Second and three, Pitt at the 35. Hurd goes in motion from his wing back right slot. Now reverse motion, movement on the left side. West Virginia's middle guard comes across the line of scrimmage. Now who moved first? And now we have the huddle of officials, and they will decide. Is it against the Panthers? Did Bill Chirpak move first, or did the nose guard cause the problem?
I think it was the defensive right tackle that made the move a little bit too soon. Lucas, is it? Or?
All right, could be. 1:49 left of the first quarter. Pitt leads 14-3, but this penalty will be against the Panthers for illegal procedure.
That's why I'm not calling it.
So instead of second and three now, that changes the play call completely because it's second and long. Line of scrimmage, back to the 29, which is correct. Third down, we'll call it at the 30-yard line. For stat purposes, 5-yard penalty makes it third down and 8. Make that second down and 8. Can't have the down turnover on a penalty. It'll be replayed. 1:49 left of the first quarter, second down and 8. New play comes in from tight end Vernon Kirk, who lines up as a wide out to the right side. Michael Stewart is way wide to the left. Panthers have wing backs to both sides. One of those is Hurd in motion. Reverse motion back to the near side, the short side. Kenjemi back on second and 8, looking. Now evades the pressure, runs to his right. Is he going to keep it? No, he fires it on the run, and it is batted out of there. Incomplete, intended for Hosea Hurd. Fine defensive play for cornerback Stacy Smith of the Mountaineers, setting up a third down and 8.
The three-man rush, and that's what they're using, by the way, that West Virginia is using because they're putting their ends in drop routes and not using a rush in, is actually causing some trouble because they're getting away late and getting in the face of Kenjemi, and he's having to roll and throw the ball. I thought there if he'd have kept it, he might have made about 10 yards. But then again, I'm not carrying the ball.
Pitt facing a third down and 8. Ball just shy of the 30-yard line. Wide part of the field to the left, and two wide outs out that way. Going that way in motion is fullback Tom Brown. Kenjemi back. Fires a pass, wide open, Brown complete at the 30, the 35, first down to the 40, and he's tackled. No, he's not. He's still on his feet out at the 45. What a bulldog effort for senior fullback Tom Brown of Burrell, Pennsylvania. Larry Holly of Ringgold High, the strong safety, and Darnell Warren, the freshman linebacker from McKeesport, finally wrapped him up, but he broke about four tackles along the way.
Tom Brown's effort there was one of probably the best I've seen this year after the catch. He held on the ball, both hands, spun out, kept digging his feet upfield, and it broke on the side away from flow. In other words, the looked like Pitt was going to throw to the right. They snuck that single back out there, and there he was in a wide open position and was able to run with power.
The 66-yard pass play Kangemi to Osborne earlier that gave Pitt the 7-3 lead is the longest for Pitt since 1980. How about that? And Ironhead Hayward with a head of steam through that middle, crosses the 50-yard line and gets into West Virginia territory after about a 4-yard pickup before he's tackled by defensive tackle Brad Hunt, the junior from Ripley, West Virginia. One of our flagship station salespeople, Dave Colwis, family is from Ripley, West Virginia, and he was telling us the pregame festivities up at the tents above the scoreboard to our left near the frat houses that he spent a lot of time on the farm down in Ripley, West Virginia. Dave Colwis, it's always nice to talk to you. From the 48-yard line of West Virginia is where the football is right now. Second down and 6. Panthers with a 14-3 lead. Late first quarter, 30 seconds left. And Jimmy back, 3-man rush. Pass is batted in, intercepted at the 46-yard line. Batted at the line of scrimmage, and diving for it was outside linebacker Matt Smith, the All-American from Gahanna, Ohio. I did not see up front who got the hand on the football. It probably could have been Brad Hunt.
It was the left tackle, Bill. And again, it was a 3-man rush. You're right. And they're causing havoc with just 3 people. They're going to have to set another tight end in there and be able to double team the nose guard and the tackle to the side of the roll, because Kangemi's getting somebody in his face every time.
Hunt tipped it. Smith intercepts in West Virginia. First and 10 after the turnover at their own 46-yard line. They trail the Panthers 14-3. The turn and the give is to the tailback, and with the football is Undra Johnson, and Undra Johnson crosses the 50 and gets to the 48-yard line of the Panthers before being tackled by Lorenzo Freeman. So that is about a 6-yard pickup into the Pitt 48-yard line, where it's second down, and we'll call it 4.
They're running hard. I can see their plan is still formulated. Run the ball inside after the pass fake and then keep the ball and roll.
The horn sounds. That's the end of the first quarter here at Pitt Stadium with a score. The Pitt Panthers 14 and the Mountaineers of West Virginia 3. As we start the second quarter, the Panthers lead at 14-3, but West Virginia now has gained back a degree of momentum. The Panthers early on got a touchdown pass of 66 yards from Kangemi to Osborne to sting West Virginia, Pitt taking a 7-3 lead. And after Billy Owens' interception, the Panthers on the second play hit Hosea Hurd wide open in the end zone for Kangemi's second touchdown pass of the afternoon. The Panthers lead at 14-3, but ever since then, Pitt has had a field position problem, and West Virginia has had the bulk of the offense going to their running game. Kangemi is 6-for-12 in the passing department for 116 yards, 2 touchdowns, but he's just been intercepted for the first time this afternoon, and for the third time in 1986.
And that because of a strong pass rush and a tip that really created the havoc. Pitt is going to have to control the defensive front, the aggressiveness of the West Virginia rush in order to throw the ball more easily, because the Pitt receivers are open. Now the West Virginia offense, I think, in order to move the ball, will have to stay with the action pass game. Either draw, fake the run, roll and pass, or bootleg and pass in order to misdirect the Pitt linebackers.
West Virginia will have a 2nd and 4 at the Pitt 48-yard line. Mike Timko, the junior quarterback, breaks him out of the huddle and puts him in an I formation. Actually, it's a power I formation on 2nd and 4 at the Pitt 48. Dotting the I is Grantis Bell, a receiver. He goes in motion. The give against it to the left side is to Undra Johnson, and he turns it upfield for short yardage. Tackled on the far side by John Carter as he falls close to the 46. Had help that time from free safety Billy Owens. About a 2-yard gain. We'll call it a 3-yard gain to the 45-yard line, and it'll be 3rd down and a long 1.
That's the first time they tried something other than the bounce out run to get wide. So they do have a play in the offense where they hand off and try to wide speed. I don't know if they're going to be able to get it done, though, with that linebacker.
Tight formation on 3rd and a long 1 for West Virginia. At the Pitt 45, they've got 2 tight ends. Motion by one of the people in the backfield, Alvin Phillips. Pass to the near side will be complete to Phillips. He's got the 1st down at the Pitt 36-yard line. Calvin Phillips, a sophomore from Boynton Beach, Florida, beating the coverage of Panther cornerback Quentin Jones. And he's knocked out of bounds on the near side of the field, but picks up the 1st down on about a 10-yard gain. We pause 10 seconds for station identification on the Panthers Football Network.
Westinghouse, 120,000 employees around the world. Dedicated to quality and excellence. 1250 WTAE, Pittsburgh.
9 yards on the pass completion for the 1st down. West Virginia at the Pitt 36, trailing 14-3. Deep handoff and through the middle is Undra Johnson, and Undra Johnson is upset as he crosses the 35 and is tackled at the 33-yard line by linebacker Steve Apke. Undra Johnson at 5'10", 200, a sophomore from Fort Lauderdale, averaging 5.3 yards a carry on the 86 season.
West Virginia is going to control the pit pass brush by continually running that, what they call cut draw, in the middle to keep the lineman from going hard on Timko.
14-3, Pitt with a lead, early second quarter, 13-47. West Virginia second and seven at the 33. Grant his bell in motion to the wide side, the left. Draw play with the football. Coming across the field is Ed Hill. Ed Hill's going to be tackled as he gets to the 30-yard line, and that's about all. Good pursuit by safety Billy Owens. And had help that time from Zeke Gatson going across the field, and they pin him down at the 30-yard line after picking up three. It'll be third down and four.
That draw play's working effectively against the Pitt defense, and I'm interested. This is a very, very hairy call.
Third down and four, wide side of the field to the right. That's where Harvey Smith lines up as a flanker. Out of the eye operates Mike Timko on third and four at the Pitt 30. Goes to the audible. Panthers stunning. Have about almost all 11 men at the line of scrimmage. Timko's back. They're in patterns. He's throwing for the end zone. Wide open. West Virginia touchdown to Harvey Smith. He beat the Panthers that time, beat Quinton Jones, and got around him. And Timko put the ball right on the money, and the Mountaineers are on the board. 30-yard touchdown pass, Timko to Smith.
What they did now, they knew the blitz was coming, automatic to the single receiver on single coverage. There's no way he could handle him. They picked up the blitz, and the man ran a post route deep and was wide open. If you can pick up a blitz and you're man-to-man, you're going to do that every time.
West Virginia on the board with their first touchdown of the afternoon, 14-9. And the extra point try is coming by Charlie Bauman out of Timko's hold. The ball is on the tee. The kick is up, and the kick is good. West Virginia cuts it to 4 points. It's 14-10. There's a break in the second quarter action, and we'll be right back.
Morning on the BBC from WTAE Radio.
West Virginia starting the drive after the interception at their own 46-yard line. Drive at 54 yards in six plays, and the capper on a third and four to Pitt 30. Timko's pass to Harvey Smith, 30 yards for the touchdown, and the Panthers get beat and now lead it by 4 points. And we were telling you that the momentum had shifted toward the Mountaineer side of the field.
Gutsy call, only because instead of trying to retain possession, they tried to score and did. And Pitt, feeling they would run the ball, put their people up and try to blow through the gaps. However, they kept everybody in and only won that single route on a post, one-on-one, on the right side of the football field. Everything was perfect for it, and the man came open.
West Virginia will kick it left to right. And the kickoff man will be Robert Woods. And he's going to tee it up on the right hash mark. The Panthers have Michael Hadley deep to receive, flanked to his right, and up ahead of him by Doug Hetzler, the freshman from North Hills High School, and by junior Nate Hayward of New Jersey, the younger brother of Ironhead Hayward. Now the West Virginia players looking to their fans in the end zone. Come on, we need some noise. And the fans respond. West Virginia, an 8-point underdog in this contest, trails it now by four with 12:54 left of the second quarter. Woods kickoff. We'll have Hetzler back there with Hadley, who takes it away and goes to the 20, the 25, the 30, hit hard and downed at the 31-yard line by Robert Pickett. Miami, Florida outside linebacker put a good solid tackle on Hadley. That time Hetzler thought he had the football, and he ranged back, but Hadley took it away from him and put on a pretty good return out of past the 30-yard line.
He did. The kid who was jumping up and down, leading all the cheers, got nailed, by the way. I just thought I'd mention it. Usually they do.
You don't think one of the Panthers saw him revving his right arm in the air, do you?
Yeah, right.
He said, I've got my man.
And he got leveled.
Panthers from their own 31, first and 10. Send Tinsley in motion from his wing back left spot. Tinsley playing wideout this week, switching over from defense. The pass complete to Hosea Hurt. Turns it upfield, has somebody on him, and drags him to the 34 for a 3-yard gain. That somebody was cornerback Preston Waters, a freshman. And if Hurd breaks that tackle, he would have had more than enough for the first down. But credit Waters, he held on and kept the gain to 3 yards. It'll be second down and seven.
I think Hurd hurt himself on that last play. He got twisted and is looking to come out of the ball game. You're right. If he could have broken away, it made more yardage. But on the other hand, if it rained today, the field would have been wet.
Hurd limping as he comes to their sideline, along with tight end Vernon Kirk. Panthers send Todd Huebner in as a tight end. And at second down, we'll call it seven. Pitt at its own 34, leading 14-10. Second quarter, 12:05 remaining. Kajemi to the audible. Redeploys Ironhead Hayward as a back to the left side. Now gives to Ironhead, and Ironhead gets through there for a couple of yards, hit hard as he gets out to about the 38-yard line and knocked backwards, but his forward progress will carry him about 4 yards to the 38, where outside linebacker Matt Smith made the sure-handed tackle on him with help from nose guard David Grant. The line of scrimmage, the Pitt 38. After the 4-yard gain, it'll be third down, a long three for the Panthers after the pickup by Craig Ironhead Hayward. Ricketts, Sine, Miller, Stepnoski, and Randy Dixon, the Panther forward wall. On a third and three, Pitt at its own 38-yard line. Osborne and Stewart come to the near sideline. Tinsley's in there as a wide out to the left. Kajemi says, I don't like what I see. We're in the wrong formation, and he calls a timeout at 11:19 left of the second quarter. Pitt leads this contest 14-10. There's a break in the action, and we'll be right back. Three allotted in the first half. John Kajemi stepped to the line of scrimmage and said, this is absolutely the wrong formation. We got the wrong people in the wrong spots. Let's get back on the right track, and he called time. Pitt facing a third and a long three. Panthers at their own 38. Pitt ahead 14-10, but momentum definitely has shifted into the direction of West Virginia. Panthers fell behind 3-0. We're suddenly up 14-3. And then West Virginia marched the ball 54 yards and capped it. Timko to Smith for the 30-yard touchdown pass. And West Virginia is very much back into things right here with a lot of time left second quarter.
Lots going to happen. Again, as I said before, on the call by West Virginia third down when they scored, this is also one of those. With third and enough that you can run for it, will you run for it? But with Tinsley in there, you might think they want to get it to Tinsley and see if he can run after the catch.
Now the Panthers get everything in order, and they face the third and three at their own 38-yard line after the timeout. Panthers stack twin wideouts wide to the left, almost to the sideline. Kajemi now looking over things. Steps in with a single setback. Scales in motion to the slot area. Kajemi back. Plants, fires, pass complete. Tinsley's got it, turns it upfield. First down and more to the 50-yard line. Fine grab by Keith Tinsley on a crossing route to the left sideline. Tackled by Preston Waters, but not before he picked up 12 yards and a Panther first down.
That's what I felt when I saw Tinsley go into the ball game. If you're putting that kind of speed in there, you don't want to go deep. You want to throw the ball in an intermediate zone and allow him to run with his speed with it, and it worked out that way. And they're going to use Tinsley with that in mind. Give him the ball short and let him run with the ball after the catch.
12-yard gain to midfield, wide side of the field to the right. Pitt moving right to left here, second quarter. Panthers have two receivers out to the wide side. Ironhead Hayward is a flanker to the left. Panthers with many, many different formations. The give is to fullback Tom Brown. Finds a crease off the left side and rambles into the 46 for 4 yards, where the entire center of that West Virginia defense, one of their strongest parts, Brad Hunt at 282, David Grant, a 280-pound junior nose guard, and Chris Parker at 278 pounds, all combined to make the stop at the 46-yard line of West Virginia. Second down four. Second down six.
Taking Ironhead out and flanking him was to check and see whose key he was on. If they had a key on Ironhead himself, and they didn't. They just played it normal.
Second and six. The ball at the West Virginia 46, wide side of the field to the right. Kajemi surveying, steps in, straight back to pass. Plants, fires, complete with a football. Billy Osborne first down to the West Virginia 31. Osborne just right over the middle, and we have a West Virginia player down in the backfield. Larry Holly of Ringgold High made the stop, and the West Virginia player who is down is David Grant, the nose guard, getting up very slowly, and now referee John Sophie comes in and says, son, you better head for the bench. You've got a problem.
That David Grant, some of his problem is that he has been on the pass rush and been so aggressive for so long, he's starting to weaken, and I have a feeling you'll see him come right back. He's limping, yes, but he could be out of wind. He's really working hard in there, and they're double-teaming him now, and this is causing him to tire out. I feel that he'll bounce back pretty soon.
15-yard gain, Kajemi to Osborne over the middle. Holly, who made the tackle, got up a little slowly, but the Ringgold product is okay. But meantime, David Grant, the nose guard, is out of the football game. He was shaken on a block by Tom Brown. John Moses, a junior from Plum High at 6'2", 266, is in for West Virginia as the backup nose guard to David Grant. First and 10, the Panthers at the West Virginia 31-yard line. Kajemi on a quick count back. Looking, firing over the middle, the pass is complete to Michael Stewart, and he's down at the 3-yard line. Michael Stewart has another Panther first down, first and goal at the 3. He split the seam between strong safety Larry Holly and cornerback Stacy Smith. Pitt with another big gainer. Stewart with a fine grab of a perfectly thrown football by John Kongemi.
The unsung hero on that play was Ironhead Hayward, who came through the line of scrimmage, settled in the middle of the field, drew the safety man up, and they were able to run the route behind him and single coverage.
28-yard gain, Kongemi to Stewart. Pitt first and goal at the West Virginia 3. Kongemi comes to the line of scrimmage and sees that West Virginia has decided to call a timeout with 9:53 left of the second quarter. So each team now has two timeouts left here in the first half. Pitt leads at 14-10. The Panthers driving for more. They hope there's a break in the action, and we'll be right back.
Power. Close out power. Only your greater Pittsburgh Pontiac dealers have it. The power to discount GM's hottest selling cars by hundreds. The power to give 2.9 annual percentage rate GMAC financing on any new 86 Pontiac you buy. The power to pass on factory incentives to save you hundreds more. Don't settle for someone's wimpy deal. Now's the time to get total savings up to thousands with 2.9% financing and close out power at your greater Pittsburgh Pontiac dealers.
You'd be amazed at what Ed Till talks about. He's on Sunday through Friday nights at 9 here on WTAE Radio.
Pitt receiver Michael Stewart, who stands 6'4", 207 pounds of Norwalk, Ohio. His longest gain of the season, a 28-yard reception to the 3-yard line. West Virginia defensively calls a timeout to try to halt some of this Panther momentum that has gradually picked up on this series. That is the third longest pass of the season. Make that the fourth longest pass thrown by Panthers quarterback John Kongemi, the 50-year senior from Lauderdale Lakes, Florida.
The fact that he held on to it was great. You know, he could hit hard enough to make the paint come off that helmet, and he hung on, and I thought he might drop it. Great hit by West Virginia on the play.
Panthers with a power formation. First and goal at the West Virginia 3-yard line. Hayward, Brown, and Lavinia, three fullbacks in there behind Kongemi. Kongemi steps in, sends Lavinia in motion. Behind it, it goes to Hayward. He's down.
Virginia.
Has it all sealed off at that point. And I believe they're only going to spot his forward progress to the 2-yard line. That's all. And so that's a 1-yard gain. It'll be second down and goal from 2 yards away.
Do that three more times and you score.
But it gets a little tougher as you get close to that goal line, does it not?
It does, and the patience run out. You want to do something tricky, and the only tricky thing in the shortest distance is right from north to south now. Right up the gut.
Hayward at 255 pounds. The tailback got 1 yard. Now it's second and goal from the 2. Again, motion by Lavinia. Again, Hayward pounds in there. He dives for the end zone and has the Panther touchdown. Ironhead Hayward. I didn't think that iron could fly.
I did. Well, that's that Dumbo the elephant just took off on that play. Boy, he looked good. I didn't think he could either. I have to kiss him again, you think?
What a move by a 255-pound man. I mean, he got airborne. He thinks he's Marcus Allen, and nobody's going to tell him any different.
Or that elephant, Dumbo.
You call him that to his face. I'll hide behind the locker while you do it, buddy.
Just after I kiss him.
Greg Hayward. His fourth rushing touchdown of the season. The extra point try by Jeff Van Horn is up and true, and the Panthers now have an 11-point lead back. It's 21-10, 9-12 left second quarter. Bill Hillgrove and Tony Mason, there's a break in the action, and we'll be right back.
Pitt Panther football, you're in for a game. That's right, you're in for a game Saturday night, October 4th, when Pitt hosts Temple. Enjoy action-packed Panther football under the stars. It's Landmark Savings Night and your chance to join in the fun and football bonanza. Tickets are on sale at any Pittsburgh National Bank, or you can order by phone. Pitt versus Temple, Saturday night, October 4th. Kickoff is at 7 o'clock. Plus, before the game, enjoy a gigantic 10 party with Red Hot and Blue. Sponsored by Radio 1250 WTAE.
The best talk show in town, Ed Till, weeknights on Radio 1250 WTAE.
Panthers march at 69 yards in 8 plays. 2 big plays in the drive. Keith Tinsley on a 3rd and 3 caught a 12-yard pass. Then Billy Osborne with a 15-yard reception to set up Pitt with a 1st and 10 at the 31. And then the biggest play of the drive, outside of the touchdown, obviously, Michael Stewart's first down grab of a 28-yard aerial from John Kongemi that gave the Panthers the 1st and goal at the 3. 2 plays later, Dumbo, alias Ironhead Hayward, flying over the top for the score.
You notice I restrained from saying kiss him on the lips like I did last week, because he chased me yesterday around the practice field, and that was one fat guy chasing another fat guy. So today I said kiss and I will definitely do it on top of his helmet.
You missed Ironhead's performance on the Myron Cope talk show Thursday night.
Oh, no, he sang
Strangers in the Night.
It was strange when he went up in the air there.
And Myron questioned him and said, Craig, wait a minute. This is not your genre. You're a member of the younger generation. Why would you sing a song for my generation? He said, you're listening to old Blue Eyes.
I didn't hear that one.
John Kangemi, 10 for 16, 175 yards, two touchdowns. He's been intercepted once. Pretty good performance again for the fifth-year senior. Mark Brasco's kickoff is high. Ranging under it, Darren Fulton back at his own one. Out behind the wedge at the 5, the 10. Now he's in trouble. Spins, and he's dropped at the 15-yard line. Had nowhere to go. Tried it to the left. Matt Bradley was there. Tried it to the right. Nothing there. The Panthers just caved in on him, and down he goes at the 15, where West Virginia has a 1st and 10. I'd like to greet our listeners along the Panther Radio Network up in Latrobe on WCNS in Arnold Palmer country, up in Oil City on WRJR, and over in Phoenixville in the eastern part of the state. Hello to those listeners on WYIS. Pitt against Temple next Saturday night, 7 o'clock airtime on our Panther Network will be 6:30. Now there's that eye stack, that power eye formation. The receiver, Grannis Bell, comes out of it, and the give is to the tailback, Hollifield. He's got nowhere to go. Got a yard, and that's about all. The brick was there. Walter Johnson, the 255-pound senior defensive tackle from Pahokee, Florida. Panthers have had four players from Pahokee. I want to say that Ricky Jackson, obviously, was from Pahokee, Florida. Clint Wilson, the tight end from last year, was from Pahokee, Florida. And then way back in the John Majors era, there was a wide receiver by the name of Carlton Williams. Not Williamson, not the guy who's with the 49ers, but Williams, also from Pahokee, which is down west of Palm Beach near Lake Okeechobee. Enough of geography, let's get back to football. 2nd and 9, West Virginia from his own 16. Draw play, Pecan, short yardage out to about the 17, and he's tackled fairly quickly by the Panther defenders. The linebackers were there, and Steve Apke got to him first.
They're running the ball in that area. They have to, because they can't afford to make a mistake now. If they do, Pitt could break the game, not wide open, but break it enough to have it comfortable. And so I have a feeling this time, if they throw, it'll be very short or run the draw.
Pitt leads at 21-10. West Virginia, 3rd and 8 at their own 17. Timko with a wing back right. Rolls right. Sets, plants. Now Tony Woods is after him, and Timko is going to go down at the 5-yard line. Tony Woods all over him. Tony Woods beat his single blocker, just bumped him out of the way. And meantime, from the backside, Bert Grossman was helping out. You talk about a great pair of defensive ends. Like to have those two line up down after down for you, wouldn't you, Coach?
I'll say, and what they didn't do was throw short. Because they didn't have enough time. If they had thrown short, he'd got rid of the football. Trying to throw it long, he didn't buy enough time, and the pass rush obviously got to him.
Line of scrimmage is 7 after the 10-yard loss. Punter Lance Carrion awaiting the snap in his own end zone. And on 4th down, he'll kick a low driving spiral that'll send Billy Osborne to the 49 of Pitt. Straight ahead to the 45 of West Virginia, spinning, twisting, and down he goes at the 43-yard line. Fine punt return for Billy Osborne after Carrion does a good job of blasting the ball out of his end zone, but the Panthers have great field position with a 21-10 lead to start the drive. 1st and 10, Pitt will have it at the West Virginia 40, we'll call it the 43-yard line.
Some scores, Bill. In the first quarter, Cornell Colgate 0-0. Down in the south, 14-0. Clemson over Georgia Tech in the second quarter.
Of course, later this afternoon, number 1 meets number 2. That should be quite a thriller in Miami between the Sooners and the Canes. Only the 20th time in history that number 1 meets number 2 in the season. Jimmy back on 1st down from the 43. Wide open complete to Michael Stewart. He is hit hard at the 31, but he's got a Panther 1st down. Darnell Warren, inside linebacker from McKeesport, a freshman, and Preston Waters, the freshman cornerback, pinched on him and got him on the hard tackle, but he held onto the football and down.
Panthers are driving people through the deep zones and settling people underneath in the curl areas. Let's see if they continue that procedure. If they do, they're going to eat up the 10 yards in a hurry.
Wide side of the field to the right. Osborne is out that way with Hosea Hurd. 1st and 10, Pitt at the 30. The give to Tommy Brown, and he'll get back to the line of scrimmage, and that's all. He got forward progress. May have lost a yard to the 31. He is hit hard by Robert Pickett. Pickett, a very fine outside linebacker, with help from inside linebacker Eric Lester, who came across to hit him and hit him from the side. That's a loss of 1 for Tommy to the 31. It'll be 2nd down 11 for the Panthers at the West Virginia 31. Pitt leading 21-10. The touchdowns, 2 touchdown passes. Kangemi to Osborne of 66 yards. Kangemi to Hurd of 19 yards. And then the 2-yard dive by Craig Ironhead Hayward to make it 21-10. Second down and 11. Center Mean Ed Miller out over the football. Keith Tinsley in motion to the wide side where the Panthers overload the zone. Back is Kingemi. Has time. Now pumps once. Going to be flushed out of there. Throws a pass over the middle. It's incomplete. He tried to hit Keith Tinsley. It was too far for Tinsley, crossing from his left to his right. Then Hosea Hurd coming from the other side was on the backside of the play but had no chance on the ball. And it'll be third down and 11. That time, West Virginia had receivers pretty well covered. You could tell by John Kingemi's actions. He's trying to read somebody open and finally had to force the throw.
He was supposed to throw to Tinsley first in the flat, but they had a man settled on him. Tinsley smartly drove across the middle. John saw he was covered and actually threw that ball away into the open area, middle of the field, because everybody was covered, as you had said.
The incomplete pass sets up a third down and 11 at the 31, and the clock stops momentarily at 5:51, second quarter. Stay tuned for halftime. We'll have an interesting guest. Pat Livingston, the longtime sports editor of the Press. Kingemi back on third down, and he's going to fire for the end zone, and we've got a Panther touchdown. Wide open, Keith Tinsley had gotten behind cornerback Stacy Smith, and what a job of reading open receivers by John Kingemi under some pressure.
John threw the ball perfectly. Tinsley settled in the end zone. Smith gave up. Smith thought that he was sacked.
And not only that, you figure when you got to throw the ball 40 yards in the air, it's going to have time for Smith to recover. He fired a bullet
right into the corner, and Tinsley, for a transfer secondary man, stood in that corner and bought time. He did a fine job waiting.
Keith Tinsley's first career touchdown reception. Van Horn to try the extra point out of Kingemi's hold. It's up, it's true, and the Panthers lead it by a score of 28-10. And suddenly, momentum is back on the blue shirt side of the field. 5:43 left, second quarter. With timeout on the field, the score of the Panthers 28 and West Virginia 10. John Kingemi has fired his third touchdown pass of the afternoon, and the Panther fans love it here at Pitt Stadium. A 31-yarder to Keith Tinsley, converted defensive back, who came over after the injury to Reggie Williams to help out, and helping out he has done. 12 for 19, Kingemi, 219 yards. In addition to his three touchdowns, he has thrown just one interception on the afternoon.
Let's see how they do in the wedge this time. They're so far... Brasco's been kicking the ball so high on the kickoff that the wedge is delayed and they're able to come around the backside of the wedge. I'm afraid of their wedge. West Virginia's wedge is devastating.
Darren Fulton, the great speedster, awaiting Brasco's kickoff. This one is a driving knuckleball. It's going to have an automatic touchdown on the bouncing in the end zone. Fulton went across the field to try to field it, and such leg drive was put on the ball that he had no chance to get it. We got a marker down. Let's wait and see. It is a touchback in the end zone. The ball is automatically in college football. The ball, when it's hitting the turf in the end zone, is automatically a touchback. In pro football, of course, it's still a live ball and can be returned. College, you can't do it. Now let's see what the flag's all about.
Fortunately, the flag in the end zone is blowing that way. That's why he's able to knuckle that into the end zone.
Panthers had somebody offsides. And so on the kick coverage unit, somebody was a little too eager, and that effort is all for naught. Now what you don't want to see is the Fulton to have a big return.
Right from that strong wedge. If he keeps the wind and it's building up, and if he drives it like he did, he's going to be able to control the ball. However, if he kicks a high kick and they get the double wedge form, you got to hold your breath unless one of those guys take the knock of that wedge out. And it'll be interesting for the people to watch now how Pitt will take on that wedge. Somebody's going to have to dive in the middle of it.
He'll have to re-kick it from the 30-yard line to our right. The Panthers leading at 28-10. Kingemi, three touchdown passes, and Ironhead Hayward, a diving effort for the fourth. Fulton now will move up to about the 6-yard line. Here comes Brasco's second kick. This one will be high, not as deep, with a lot of rotation. Fulton gets it behind the wedge at the 8-yard line, up the left side to the 15, the 20, 25, 30. Still on his feet at 35, 40, 45, and he's out of bounds across the field at the 43-yard line. He had a head of steam and wanted to go all the way. Knocking him out on the far side was Nate Hayward, the younger brother of Ironhead Hayward, but West Virginia now with fine field position, first and 10 at their own 43-yard line. Mike Timko, their junior quarterback, 3 for 11 in the passing department for 43 yards. He has one touchdown to his credits, has been intercepted one time in this game.
That's what we're afraid of on that kickoff, just what I said. The wedge did form, they did get behind it, and they were able to make a good yard. He almost went all the way with it.
We said 43. That was the second time he was out of bounds. Upfield, he was out at the 34-yard line. First down, West Virginia. Timko, short pocket pass right side. It is complete with the football. Harvey Smith tackled immediately after a gain out to the 40-yard line of 6 yards. Quinton Jones quickly on the play to make the tackle for the Panthers.
The short pass on the out route. They're doing that now, as we said before. The pass rush is so devastating at this time. They're going to have to run the draw, and they're going to have to throw the ball short to the wide people or use an action pass. I look for draw right now.
Second down, 4, West Virginia, trailing 28-10, 5:08 left second quarter from their own 40. Now they go on the counter sweep, and with the football is the wide receiver, Grannis Bell, turns it upfield and is knocked out of bounds as he gets to the 44-yard line, very close to first down yardage. I think he's going to be perhaps the length of the football short. Got to remember now, the ball's on the near side of the field out of bounds, and it depends on where they set it down. And they look, and they set it down just short of the 44, so he'll be short of first down yardage. He'll be third down in about a foot. Troy Washington made the defensive play on the near sideline for the Panthers.
Good call by West Virginia. They got him all on motion and got him flowing in one direction and came back with the reverse, and they were able to make good yardage, enough for almost make first down.
Got 4 yards. Now it's third down in about a foot. West Virginia 3 for 8 on third down tries, and Holyfield plunges in there and has the first down as he gets out across the 45 to the 46-yard line where John Carter puts the tackle on him. But not before West Virginia brings up a first down. First and 10, the Mountaineers at their own 46. They trail 28-10 with 4:55 left. Our Panther Network crew poised, as always, to greet you along the network around the great state of Pennsylvania and the tri-state area. Our producer, Larry Richard, our engineer, Thad Major, our assistant producer, Mark Wallace, and our spotters, George Levy and Don DeBlasio. Timko back on first down, throwing a pass far side of the field. It is complete. And Smith breaks a tackle and gets it upfield for the first down into Pitt territory, where he's knocked out of bounds at the Pitt 37-yard line by Gary Richard, the opposite cornerback.
Two things could have occurred on that play. One, it could have been intercepted. Two, because he missed a tackle, it could have gone all the way. He jumped in front of the ball and didn't make the hit, only made a half a tackle, and West Virginia almost turned that into a score.
22-yard pickup for the Mountaineers, and a first and 10 at the Pitt 36. Timko back to pass. Throwing for the end zone, right sideline. The Panther defender is down there, and it is incomplete. Grannis Bell, the intended receiver, had no chance because with great coverage on his inside shoulder was Quinton Jones, the junior from Pompano Beach, a play very reminiscent of the play against Purdue last week in which he ended up with the football before going out of bounds.
He almost had that one. In fact, I think the receiver from West Virginia stripped it away from him because he was in better position to catch the ball than was the receiver.
It was Harvey Smith who made that 22-yard gain, and now this time the intended receiver has no chance. Grannis Bell outside the shoulder of Quinton Jones. Second down, 10 after the incompletion, and the give is to Chris Pecan on the draw, and the fullback gets about a yard, and that's all. Maybe 2 yards to the 34-yard line, where he's tackled by the Panthers' secondary man, Robert Bradley, the nickelback. We pause 10 seconds for station identification on the Panthers Football Network.
Westinghouse, 120,000 employees around the world, dedicated to quality and excellence. 1250 WTAE, Pittsburgh.
West Virginia, third down and 8 at the Pitt 34. They trail 28-10, late second quarter. The give is to Holyfield, and he'll be hit immediately as he tries the middle. West Virginia trying to cross the Panthers up by running the football on third and long. Walter Johnson wasn't fooled, neither was Steve Apke, and they combined on the tackle after an advance in across the 35 to the 30. Well, back to the line of scrimmage. So it's fourth down and 8. And here comes the punt team on for West Virginia. Lance Kerrion is on there. And West Virginia in this situation in the past has shown the ability to come up with that short snap and try to run it. Let's see what they do here. The up back is Pecan. Lance Kerrion awaits the deep snap. Line of scrimmage at 34. He gets the deep snap. And he punts it for the Coffin corner left side. And it will go out of bounds in the Coffin corner at about the 4-yard line. So a fine effort by Kurt Kerrion has the Panthers pinned back. 3:02 left second quarter. Pitt with 2 timeouts left in the first half, but the Panthers a big 18-point lead.
That punt was a very serious punt. I say that only because Now Pitt can't open up their offense like they'd like to. They're going to have to put two hands on the football, get into an area where they either break on a long run, throw a short pass that they can run after the catch, or get in their strong position to punt the ball away.
The last time John Kangemi has thrown for three touchdowns in a football game was in 1984 against Penn State. He's thrown for three today. Not likely to throw it in this instance, but you never know. Pitt first and 10 from their own four. Turn around and a give to Tommy Brown. Fights his way out across the five to about the 8 yard line. Good hard inside running by Tom Brown, the senior from Laurel Burl, the younger brother of John Brown, who made that great catch in the Sugar Bowl game on the Dan Marino pass when the Panthers beat Georgia following the 81 season. Robert Pickett made the tackle for West Virginia. Randy Dixon shaken up slightly and comes to the sideline. Panthers make a change at offensive tackle. Chris Getz is in there to take Dixon's place on the right side of the Panther forward wall. The left tackle is Tommy Ricketts. Hosea Hurd comes to the sideline. And the turn and the give, and with the football, Tommy Brown, great effort, second effort, and a first down out across the 15 to the 18 to the 19-yard line. Tom Brown just put the head down and just drove and split the linebackers Lester and Warren and got the first down thanks to a fine block from All-America Mark Stepnoski, the right guard from Erie Cathedral Prep at 6'3", 255, a great one.
That play took him out of sweat zone. Now they can do a little bit more if they want. They can throw into the short area and go up top if they want to try to get this game on ice.
Brown picked up 4 yards, and then he picks up 11 and a Panther first down. So he's got 15 yards on this drive alone. And he's going to get more as he stumbles off the left side. Somebody got his legs. Robert Pickett got his legs and dragged him down. But he stumbles forward across the 20 to about the 22-yard line for 3 yards. And the Panthers will run some time off the clock. We're down to 1:40 first half. Panthers leading 28-10. Three touchdown passes by John Kangemi of 66, 19, and then of 30 yards, 31 yards to Keith Tinsley. And then the 2-yard plunge, or the dive, I should say, by Ironhead Hayward. Second down, 7. The Panthers from their own 22. Carry and Findham back in the coffin corner. They're out of that right now. Just want to move the football. Here comes Ironhead through a big hole. The Red Sea parted. He gets to the 30. First down to the 35, where Preston Waters got his legs and down he went. Ironhead had plenty of room on both sides. Panthers had that big a hole off that left side. Is that the bounce play?
That's not, well, he bounced off the guard, but that's not really the bounce play. It was a matter of pick your hole on the drive. I look for him to go up top now and look for Tinsley deep.
13 yards on the carry by Ironhead Hayward. First and 10, the Panthers from their own 35. Clock is down to 54 seconds. West Virginia can stop it twice if they so choose. Over the middle, the pass is overthrown. Oh, and what a hit on the intended receiver on Keith Tinsley, and flags fly everywhere. There are four markers down on the field. Four officials let the flags fly on the late hit by Larry Holly, the strong safety from Ringgold. The ball's already overthrown. It's already hit the carpet. Then all of a sudden, Holly has a message for Tinsley.
That's what I thought they'd do, Bill. I thought they'd try to get Tinsley deep.
Well, you know what's that's going to happen right now? That's 15. That's going to put the Panthers in scoring range.
Right, and they'll go again. That Tinsley took a shot and got up and bounced back. I admire the young man. They probably knew what I knew, what I thought I knew, and we're going to keep him from getting into the deep zone. And he almost did get into that deep zone. And don't be afraid if they don't go up top again.
Personal foul against West Virginia, has the ball at midfield. So they're not quite yet in scoring range, but they've got 46 seconds. That may change the philosophy now. Instead of trying to kill the clock, you might try to get another field goal.
Right. There's no doubt in my mind they're not going to try to kill it.
Panthers have two timeouts left, and they expire one of them right now. Pitt has called its second timeout of the first half. Pitt has one remaining. Nope, they say West Virginia has called the timeout, so the Mountaineers have one remaining. 46 seconds left of the second quarter. Pitt leads 28-10. There's a break in the action, and we'll be right back.
Would you call it?
Has called a timeout, and Tony Mason, you've got a quizzical look on your face here.
Well, that leaves Pitt with two timeouts and 46 seconds to go. Plenty of time with a passing team to move it down. Call a timeout and have one timeout left to kick the ball. I think I'd let the ball run and let Pitt blow one of the timeouts. I'm not sure that of why they did it, unless they wanted to get more TV coverage. I don't know.
Well, that's what everybody wants, is more TV coverage.
Could have been, but it was not a good call, as far as I'm concerned. But I'm not coaching, and I'm sure he had a reason to do it.
You got some newspaper print coverage this past week. Are you looking for TV coverage this week?
No, they said as a homer. I'd love Pitt.
No, they didn't use the word homer.
Oh, didn't they?
It was boosterism. You're guilty of boosterism.
I am boosting Pitt. That's too bad. I like Pitt.
First and 10, the Panthers at the 50-yard line. After the personal foul and after the West Virginia timeout, Tinsley reverse motion to the left. Jimmy back, 46 seconds. Big rush. He's looking. Flag is down, and the pass is incomplete. Almost intercepted by Matt Smith. And we've got a player down. Eric Lester almost intercepted that. Panthers' Tommy Ricketts was spun off his feet. Panthers apparently guilty of a holding call here near midfield, and that'll pretty well... Let's see what the call is. Referee John Sophie says face mask against West Virginia. I see what happened. One of the defenders used the mask to get the blocker off his feet.
That was complete havoc on that play. Pitt had tried to set up a running screen to Tinsley with two linemen out front, and West Virginia read it perfectly, came underneath and stood in front of it, and then John Congemi attempted to, on his own, move around and find another open man and throw the ball away so it didn't get lost yardage. But it was a screen pass, run a foul.
15-yard penalty against West Virginia, their second serious penalty of this drive. Mountaineers really stung by the fact that the personal foul call and now the mask call goes against them. And suddenly the Panthers, with 38 seconds and two timeouts, have a first and 10 at the West Virginia 35-yard line. Pitt leading 28-10. Trying to get a couple more here. Blitz by West Virginia. Flags in the air. They whistle the play dead. And apparently there was movement before the snap. That's a dead ball foul. They didn't let that one get underway.
And if you look upfield, Bill, there were three receivers in the end zone. They were trying to get deep. So he was going up top. I think now, because West Virginia saw that, they'll use stop routes, which means they'll pretend they're going up deep. They'll stop and go into the field goal section of the field.
Panthers are guilty of procedure. Somebody moved ahead of the snap, and that's why the play was not allowed. And it's probably just as well, because Congemi was on the run for his life. West Virginia was in on him. False start for the Panthers. Hayward is in there. Brown is out. Bob Sine in at left guard in place of Bill Chirpak for the Panthers. Sine, the junior from Arlington, Texas. And the Panthers' deep snapper. Vernon Kirk lines up as a wideout right side with Scales. Michael Stewart, who made a big play on the earlier touchdown drive, actually two earlier touchdown drives ago. Now we have another indication from John Sophie, the referee, who is talking to the press box. We are not privy to that conversation, but he's explaining why they're going to delay even further the last 36 seconds of this second quarter. Oh, he's saying that the clock is wrong. The 36 is not correct. 28 seconds is correct. Is that right?
I don't know. I didn't hear any of that.
And our spotter, Don DeBlasio, who's right on the play, says, I read his lips. With eyes like that, I want you to go deer hunting with me.
Really, Don?
28 seconds left of the second quarter. Pitt at the 40-yard line of West Virginia. And with the football on the draw play is Ironhead Hayward, and he'll get in across the 35 to the 33-yard line. And does Pitt stop the clock?
They sure do.
Now, the scoreboard clock says 28 seconds. There's a disparity of 8 seconds here. So we're down to 20 seconds.
They're going field goal. They're playing for field goal now. Called the time now. Now they're going to get to an out route. Or if they don't get the ball out of bounds when they catch the ball, they'll throw the ball in the middle. And if they do get the ball on the intermittent route, they'll call time and get an opportunity to kick the ball probably about 30, 35 yards out. I would think they're playing now for the field goal and try to hit an out route, as I said before, or a possession cut and call time.
Okay, the scoreboard clock says 28 seconds remaining of the second quarter. And again, when he speaks into his wireless mic, referee John Sophie cannot be heard by us in this part of the press box. And we really are guessing as to how much exact time is left, so bear with us. It says 28 on the clock, and we'll just quote that. And the Panthers are out of timeouts. West Virginia has one remaining. 30 seconds should be on the clock instead of 28. Now it begins to turn. Are they going to recycle? They get it down to 25. Now they get it back to 30. And the crowd responds with that mock cheer. Thank you, George Levy. Our spotter, George Levy, says, I thought it was 30, and he was trying to tell us that, but we wouldn't listen to him. We're a little stubborn in the booth today. Randy Dixon has a twisted right ankle. He's going to undergo x-rays at halftime. Panthers could ill afford a loss in that offensive line, which basically has been relatively injury-free this year. But if you would lose a player like Randy Dixon for any length of time, it would hurt. The best Panther offensive lineman since Bill Frelick, and that is a big statement. With 30 seconds left, Kenjemi back from the 35, throws a pass near side for Hurd. It's out of bounds, incomplete. Stacy Smith, the cornerback, had the coverage on Hurd. That stops the clock at 26 seconds. Pitt now will face third down and 9.
With no timeouts, they'll throw another out route.
Line of scrimmage is the West Virginia 33-yard line. Panthers have to get to the 22 for a first down and have to at least complete one more pass to try to set up a field goal try.
And they got to get out of bounds when they catch the ball in order to get the field goal off.
And West Virginia, knowing that, let me just make the adjustment. And if you see a pickoff here, it could be back for a big gainer going back the other way. Third and 9, Pitt at the 33, Kenjemi straight back. Big rush, blitz. Firing pass near sideline. And with the football is Michael Stewart. They say keep the clock running. He was tackled out of bounds on the near side of the field, and John Kenjemi comes down and calls a timeout. Now, the scoreboard said Pitt didn't have any timeouts left, but I think Panthers had one left.
Oh, okay.
They missed on the West Virginia side. They have two up for West Virginia. Remember, West Virginia took that one funny timeout that you questioned?
Okay.
They never switched it on the scoreboard. They thought Pitt took the timeout.
Bill, the receiver on that play made a mistake. He should have went out of bounds as soon as he caught the football.
It doesn't matter because it's ineligible receiver downfield anyhow. The Panthers will be penalized.
Well, see, you knew that, and now you're going to make me...
I didn't know that.
But he should have gone out of bounds anyway. He better learn from that.
I have to try to be honest. And, Mr. Mason, with you, sometimes that's very difficult.
I know that. And that right there, I believed he should go out of bounds, and he'd better, I believe he's getting talked to now.
Ball was spotted back at the 39 after the penalty for ineligible receiver downfield. And now we have a conference between the officials. And now... Referee John Sophie says Pitt has called the timeout, so that stops the clock at 21 seconds left of the second quarter. Pitt ahead 28-10. It's just a matter of whether the Panthers have a chance to add to that lead right now. For a while after West Virginia committed a personal foul and a major mask penalty, face mask penalty, that the Panthers were in scoring range, but then the Panthers since then have had a procedure call, now an ineligible receiver downfield call, and suddenly they're back up out of field goal range. So it's up to Kenjemi now with no timeouts to try to get him back there.
Now, what that discussion is, when the play occurred, just as I said he should have gone out of bounds, they call time, okay? Then suddenly there's a flag and they say the ball has to be brought back. So Pitt says, no, I don't want the time because we don't need it. This has changed and altered it. But the officials called it, and Mike is having a coronary because they held with the first call. I believe the official is correct. I'm sorry, Mike, but I think that.
John Sophie indicating to the press box, Pitt is out of timeouts, pumps his arm three times, all three are gone. West Virginia has one remaining. 21 seconds left of the second quarter. Pitt ahead 28-10 with a third down, 15 at the West Virginia 39. Kenjemi back with one back behind him. Rolls right, has open field, turns it upfield, cuts it back, needs a block, turns it at the 30, still on his feet at the 25, out of bounds at the 25-yard line with 12 seconds left of the half. What a heads-up job of running by John Kenjemi, and what a good move in the middle of the football field.
If they had that, now that's an if, but if that call had not gone through on the last play, Kenjemi had running room for about 15 more yards, which would have been a sure pot, but he did the thing that he should have done, get out of bounds, set it up for the field goal, which is realistic right now.
He's 1 yard short of the sticks. It's not a first down, so on fourth down, the Panthers are forced to try the field goal with 12 seconds left. Jeff Van Horn will be kicking angle left to right out of Kenjemi's hold, a 42-yard field goal attempt by the right-footed sidewinder from Cheney Washington. The ball's on the tee, and the kick is long enough. And it's high enough, and the kick is good. 42-yard field goal with 6 seconds left of the half by freshman Jeff Van Horn, and the Panthers are on top 31-10. And we haven't completed a half of football. Started to say, Tony Mason, that our halftime guest, a wealth of football information over the years, Pat Livingston, the former sports editor of the Pittsburgh Press, longtime writer with the Pittsburgh Steelers, a guy who has followed college football throughout his long, illustrious career, and it'll be a lot of fun to talk to P. Murray about some old times.
Well, he's a good friend of mine also and covered us at the Fiesta Bowl, and I'm looking forward to it. He's a fine man.
In his retirement years, enjoying the game of golf. And he told me the other day, and I'll nail him about it at halftime, that they had a member at his golf course recently. And he's playing so badly that nobody would play with him. So he watched.
He's still doing that same media stuff, isn't he?
Well, I'll tell you what.
The truth, I'll tell you what.
He's the strongest 30 handicapper I know. Panthers field goal drive, 71 yards in seven plays, a 42-yarder by Van Horn with 6 seconds left of the half. Van Horn now has suddenly a pretty good percentage on the year. He came on replacing Mark Brasco after Brasco missed three against Maryland, and Jeff Horn has responded. Van Horn has responded. He is now 3 of 5.
And the two he was after were out of his range. You know, that was looked good. As you had mentioned in his extra points, Bill, he hit two knucklers line drive for the extra points, but that was a beautifully popped kick there and went through with plenty to spare.
31-10. Van Horn now will kick it off instead of Mark Brasco. Let's look for the squib kick here to try to neutralize the return game of West Virginia. That's exactly what it is. He kicks a real knuckler here. One of the up people has it for West Virginia. That is Roman Nelson up the left side with a block at the 30. Still on his feet and down at the 35, the 36-yard line, the final play of the second quarter. Matt Bradley, special teams player with the tackle on that play. So the Panthers lead it by a bunch as the teams head for the locker rooms. That's the end of the first half with a score. The Pitt Panthers 31, West Virginia 10.
Okay, Dad, where are we going?
I want to show you something.
Oh, what kind?
Sports car.
Yeah? Well, a sports car? Wait,
yeah. My fans who are in attendance here, a sellout crowd. Look at the halftime stats, Pat Livingston. 137 total yards for West Virginia to 304 for the Panthers, and of course that's directly reflected on the scoreboard.
Shows right in the game, yes. That's
many times stats do not reflect what has happened on the football field, and I've heard coaches say stats are for losers. Is that right?
That's right. You can't worry about them. Look at the first three games. Pitt's stats were overwhelming.
Well, I'll tell you, a lot of people ridicule stats, but the game is still decided on stats. The points, number of points scored and for and against.
That's right.
And that is the big statistic.
That's the ultimate statistic. Yeah. And a lot of times you'll see players, especially when the talking gets a little loud back and forth across the ball, some players just point at the scoreboard and say, you know, that's your answer right
that's
there.
It.
We were talking about John Kangemi. There's a great tradition of quarterbacks at the University of Pittsburgh, and not just Dan Marino, who probably was the best of them, but back in the Corny Salvatera days. And I remember Dave Havern running around driving defenses crazy, and Bob Basilak, not real good years under Dave Hart, but still a good quarterback out of McKeesport. They've had a few here.
I'll tell you, a fifth quarterback who is entertaining me tremendously these days is Jim Trafficant. I watch him on C-SPAN in Congress.
Well, you know, and for people who knew Jim as an undergraduate, he was always entertaining back in those days.
Oh, he's a very entertaining, he's a wonderful guy.
The man does not shy from controversy.
He sure doesn't. And then he gets in trouble and he defends himself. He's his own attorney. He's an unusual person.
That's the quarterback for you.
Yep.
And a Youngstown product.
Yep, I'm for him all the way.
And you know another thing about quarterbacks, and they talk about all the problems colleges have educating their people and everything else, but you go through and you look through the pro football, and all of those quarterbacks have degrees. 95% of the quarterbacks have degrees.
And some with great success, as you mentioned, Trafficant. How about the guy by the name of Kemp, Jack Kemp?
How about Fran Tarkenton, who owns his own software company in that computer business?
Of course, like 10% of that, actually.
Wizard White wasn't a quarterback, but he certainly was a pretty good football player.
You know an interesting thing about quarterbacks? Some of the greatest quarterbacks I've ever seen, Sammy Baugh, Otto Graham, Bobby Lane, weren't quarterbacks at all in college. They were tailbacks.
Well, it says something about the game of football, I think. And I think what it says, and it still becomes a very basic thing of blocking and tackling.
Well, that was, Pat, wasn't that because they were using the single wing a lot then, too?
Nobody played the T in those
days. That's right. So the man who was in the deep slot in the wing was like a quarterback.
Yeah.
He ran, spun,
mm-hmm. That's
threw.
Right.
He was the guy he just mentioned.
Sammy Baugh went a long time through his career before he ever played quarterback.
Right. He was in a single wing tail.
Yes. Loaded question, curveball. Who was the greatest football player you ever saw?
Greatest football player I ever saw? Oh, I just could not answer that because I saw so many good ones. I mean, I have never seen a better runner than Jimmy Brown.
I agree with you there.
I have never seen a better quarterback than Norm Van Brocklin or Sammy Baugh.
How about Dick Butkus? He comes up in the close.
Dick Butkus?
For linebackers. Maybe it was because I saw him in college, too. He killed us.
Well, I'll tell you, Jack Lambert and Jack Ham.
Yeah, okay.
Andy Russell were.
I'll go with that.
And three linebackers were absolutely fabulous.
How about Joe Schmidt?
Joe Schmidt was great. Bill George, Waynesburg. Sam Huff. who played in this series for years and years.
Pat, we appreciate you dropping by here, and enjoy that golf game and those retirement years, but it's always nice to talk to a football aficionado like Pat Livingston.
I enjoyed it. My pleasure, Pat, really.
Former sports editor of the Pittsburgh Press. That concludes the halftime show. The Panthers lead at 31-10. We'll have the second half kickoff between Pitt and West Virginia in just a minute.
That's going to be a concern of the Pitt coaches. Can they stay with it?
In that first half, John Kangemi was 12 for 20 passing for 219 yards, three touchdowns. The 66-yarder, by the way, was the longest of his career. He was not sacked. West Virginia's Mike Timko was 5 for 14. He had one intercepted, threw for one touchdown, 67 yards total. He was sacked one time by Tony Woods. West Virginia wants the football, trailing by 21 points as we get set to start the third quarter. And the ever-dangerous Darren Fulton will be back to receive the kickoff. And in there for Pitt to try the kickoff honors is Mark Brasco. Both he and Jeff Van Horn have had this honor today of kicking the ball off. Brasco, the junior from Jeanette, says, "I'm ready." Fulton says, "I'm ready." The officials say, "Let's go," and the ball is in the air. Fine kickoff by Brasco. Sends Fulton 3 yards deep. He wants to bring it out behind the wedge. Up the left side, across the 5, to the 10, running out of pasture at the 15, and a flag is down at the 28-yard line, away from the play. I don't know what that is, but there was nobody in the vicinity where the flag came down. Robert Bradley forced the return man, Darren Fulton, out of bounds on the far side of the field as he crossed the 20-yard line, and that's all the farther he got. He got to the 20, and that was it. Now, let's see what the flag is down four on the 28-yard line. Let's see the reason for its being on the surface and out of a pocket. Referee John Sophie says holding against West Virginia. Somebody saw a hold early on during the return, and so that will cost the Mountaineers half the distance to the 10-yard line.
They changed their kickoff return. If you notice, they didn't use the wedge. They used what we call a double turnout, and they put two men blocking out on the corners to find out which one hit what seam it'd take. And I think the two men blocking on this side held the contain man, but they did away with their wedge, which I thought was rather effective.
Timko came in completing more than 50% of his passes. He was 46 of 91 for 547 yards and three touchdowns, was intercepted twice. His longest pass, 46 yards. Has one touchdown pass in this game. Is backed up by Ben Reed. Whether we'll see Reed before the end of the game is right now a matter of conjecture. First and 10, West Virginia at its own 10-yard line. Play action fake. Timko rolls back by his one, throws a pass complete to Pecan out of the backfield. He's at the 15, the 20. He's got a first down at the 25 and is not tackled until he gets out to the 26-yard line. Pecan, the fullback, circling out of the backfield, was wide open. Finally, linebacker Darrell Woods from the weak side and cornerback Quentin Jones came across the field to make the tackle on the big fullback. Pecan, a very fine, aggressive runner from Laurel Highlands, 6 feet tall, 218 pounds. That's a 16-yard pickup for West Virginia first down out to the 26. West Virginia first and 10 from their own 26, and the give is to John Hollifield, the tailback, and he gets short yardage out to about the 29 before a host of blue shirts has him surrounded. Walter Johnson is at the bottom of the pile. Jerry Olsovsky and Bert Grossman now limps off the field, and John Carter comes back on. We'll keep an eye on Grossman. Is he okay?
It seems like it's a slight bruise, but nothing slight when you're limping, I guess, is there?
No, he had that ankle problem that he first suffered against North Carolina State. Ball to the 30-yard line, so it's second down and 6 for West Virginia. Grandis Bell in motion to the wide side. Short pocket pass over the middle. Oh, and it's incomplete, intended for Calvin Phillips. It was wide of the mark, and Phillips got a hit from Billy Owens, although the ball just sailed right past both. Incomplete. It'll be third down and 6, and that stops the clock at 13:55. Pit ahead, in case you've just joined us, on 3 first-half touchdown passes by John Kangemi and a dive play by Craig Hayward of 2 yards. And that accounted for the 28 points and then the 42-yard field goal with 6 seconds left of the half by freshman Jeff Van Horn. Third down and 6 now. West Virginia from its own 30-yard line. They are 4 for 10 in third down play. Short pocket pass. Now Timko fades back a little bit more, and Pecan can't hold on. It would have been short of the sticks, but just to make sure, defensive back, nickelback Robert Bradley came up and stuck Pecan as the ball got there incomplete, and the West Virginia punt team is on the field.
They had a little trouble with the snap. It seems like the defensive front of Pitt forced them back into the quarterback.
Deep snapper John Stroya, a sophomore from Canton, is out over the ball, and Lance Carrion of Valley High School awaits the snap. Snap is true, no rush, and Kerrion booms it. I mean, he booms a great spiral downfield against the breeze. Taken by Billy Osborne at his own 18. Gets a block at the 20, turns it upfield at the 25, head down at the 30, and he is tackled as he gets to the 33-yard line. Another fine return for Billy Osborne, the junior from Wildwood Crest, New Jersey. And that very active outside linebacker, Robert Pickett, made the tackle for West Virginia.
Osborne has a lot of confidence now. He scared us on that first punt, but he caught the ball very well and picked up enough yardage that made it a worthwhile return. Now let's see what their attack is.
You know, Panthers came out, you could see they were tight. And again, a rivalry game will get you to do that. But you got to overcome those things. And I think Mike Gottfried had his finger on the button when he said, you've got to relax and have fun and play this game. You can't think about making mistakes, because if you think about it, you're going to do it.
You have more fun when you're ahead, you notice?
I've noticed that over the years. Unfortunately, since the renaissance of Pitt football under John Majors, continued by Jackie Sherrill and Foge Fazio, and now Mike Gottfried, it's been a nice era of Pitt football when the column on the left side is bigger than the column on the right side.
Yeah, that's right, and it's that way now, but you can believe that Mike Gottfried has no idea what the score is. Nothing as far as he's concerned.
Randy Dixon, the Panthers' All-America offensive right tackle, has a sprained ankle. He will not play the rest of this game. And I just wonder if that score up on the board has maybe some bearing on the fact that he's being held out for the second half.
It could be. But on the other hand, knowing Mike and the trainers, if there's any chance that they can injure a kid further along than he is, they'll never use him.
By the way, Pitt has a new team physician. That's Dr. Freddie Fu, who takes the place of Dr. Richard Ray. Dr. Ray will stay on as a consultant, and we'd like to welcome Dr. Freddie Fu to the Pitt football program as the new team physician. Spent a lot of time up at training camp talking about a lot of things with Dr. Fu. Very interesting gentleman. First down at 10 at the 33. The Panthers overload the right side, and the pass is too tall for Chuck Scales. John Congemi threw a ball that was not a perfect spiral, and I just wonder if the presence behind him of the on-rushing West Virginia defender didn't have something to do about that. Roaring in there to put a little pressure on him was defensive tackle Chris Parker. The pass is incomplete. It'll be second down and 10. Pitt at its own 33-yard line with a 31-10 lead early third quarter.
They had a crossing route called, and they bumped into each other. I think when John tried to hold up, because they did bump, he let the ball fly out.
Scales and Osborne's twins to the right. The wide side to the left side is Hosea Hurd. Back split behind Congemi. He's straight back to pass on second and 10. Over the middle of the pass, into and out of the hands of Osborne on a crossing route. West Virginia's defenders didn't see it, or it might have been an interception. It went through the hands of Osborne, and the West Virginia defenders just kind of stood there. They were paralyzed by the fact that the ball was in the air for such a long time, and nobody was around it to grab it. Third down and 10.
You were right. Fortunately, he did not. The defender did not see the ball because it skipped off of Osborne's arms and went right by the defender's arms.
West Virginia makes a change. Defensive tackle Pat Marlatt is out of there. And on third and 10 at the 33, Congemi is straight back, big rush. He ducks, and he's going to come out of there running the football. 30, 35, 40, first down at the 50, out to the left at the 45, 40, and dives at the 35-yard line. John Congemi lights up the crowd with another heads-up play.
Great scramble. Now, he would have done that. Remember, we talked about it in the last series of downs, but he was smart enough then to go out of bounds. This time, smart enough to stay directly in the middle of the field, because that's where the least number of football players line up.
That is a 33-yard run by John Congemi. Went back, big blitz, ducked the rush, literally ducked and went underneath it and came out of there and picked up 33 yards to the West Virginia 34 on the scramble. First down and 10 for the Panthers, who lead at 31-10. Out of the eye. The deep back is Charles Gladman. He fights his way and picks his way to the 30 to the 29-yard line. A 5-yard gain for junior Charles Gladman on his first carry from scrimmage. Robert Pickett and Chris Parker made the tackle.
They're going to be blitzing more. The linebackers for West Virginia are up snug. I think on every passing situation, especially long, they're going to bring the backers and not rely on the defenders as much as the rush.
Scales and Osborne split to the right, the wide side. Hurd lines up as a split end to the short side left. Out of the eye, Congemi on second and 5 at the 29 of West Virginia. The turn and the deep give. Second man through is Gladman, and he has got the first down as he crosses the 25. He might be short now as they spot the football just over the 25 to about the 24 and a half. Jeff Casto, inside linebacker, and Matt Smith, the outside linebacker, combined on the tackle. West Virginia has an injured player.
Third down.
Getting up slowly is Robert Pickett, and he has been active and all over that football field today. Now he's going off with what appears to be an arm problem. His right arm or shoulder and he is bent over now, and they need the training corps. They got to get him out there. He's down on one knee and needs help, obviously. Rodney Wilson, a freshman, comes on to take the place of the injured Robert Pickett. A performance by John Kingemi to be remembered by this crowd, and we've got a lot of football left. He has run the ball effectively twice. He has thrown the ball for three touchdowns. You can't ask for much more, can you not?
No, and then he's been doing it for the last 3 weeks. It's just a matter of everything getting together. Now there's a long way to go, and anything can happen, but right now he's doing a fine job.
Third down and one at the 25 after Gladman's four-yard gain, and the Panthers have Kingemi sneaking for the first down on the touch play. He just went up and touched the back of center Ed Miller, and nobody else moved except Kingemi and Miller, and off to the races he was for the first down.
Automatic call, another great call by Kingemi. The rest of the line sitting there waiting for the play. John in the center left made the first down, now in their position to field goal or throw it into the end zone for two and see if they can make it.
First down and 10, the Panthers at the 23-yard line on the keeper by John Kingemi on the quarterback sneak for the first down. Twin receivers, Scales and Osborne to the right, the wide side. Center Mean Ed Miller is out over the ball. Back split behind Kingemi. The turn and the give to Brown. Brown sidesteps a tackle, turns it to 20, the 15, the 10, and he's out of bounds just shy of the 10-yard line and tackled there by Matt Smith, the outside linebacker, with help from strong safety Larry Holly. Craig Hayward threw a great block. Tommy Brown, with real fine running, gets the Panthers another first down just at the West Virginia 10. The Panthers could make another first down about 3 inches shy of the goal line.
That's the bounce out. That's what we talked about early. Run up in there, draw the linebackers, and then on a planned scheme, dip outside and try to get inside the defensive end for the yardage he made.
Tommy Brown picks up 13 yards and a first down. First and 10 at the 10. Now they call it a 12-yard gain. Turn and the give is to Gladman. Gladman dances, but he'll be hit and dropped after an advance of little yardage by Matt Smith. Probably no gain on the play as Matt just kind of spun him down. Complete pivot around 360 degrees. Tommy Brown was in there trying to block, but the West Virginia defenders allowed minimum advance of the football. They advanced maybe one length of the football,
right,
across the 10, so we'll call it second down, and we'll call it a long nine. Pitt ahead 31-10. Early third quarter, 10:54. Now the Panthers are driving, hoping for more. Call it from the 9-yard line, and the give off the left side is it. Tommy Brown fights his way inside the 5 to the 2-yard line. Tom Brown with a classic head down fullback blast, knocking Larry Holly back. And finally, Holly got help from Stacy Smith, and the play was stopped at about the 3-yard line. Good blocking by Ed Miller and Bob Sines sprung Tommy Brown, and he took care of the rest with a head down.
I wonder if we'll see Dumbo, because there'll be two more shots straight ahead.
Ball at the 3-yard line. Third down and 3 at the 3. Remember, the Panthers can make another first down, but they got to be inches away from the goal line to do it. The lead stick is about 4 inches shy of the goal line. Third down and 3 from the 3. Motion by Brown. The turn, the play action fake, the roll by Kingemi. Fall the end zone, incomplete for Tommy Brown. He'd gotten around the defender, but Kingemi on the run overthrew Brown in the right corner of the end zone. It'll be fourth down, and Jeff Van Horn is on with the field goal unit.
Kingemi, as he rolled, had a man in his face, and he had to throw the ball up a little higher than he wanted to. That was defense very well by West Virginia.
Panther offensive players look to the bench as if to say, come on, let's go for it. And Mike Godfrey says, no, you got to take three in this instance.
That's right. You got to give what you can on the board.
It's a 21-point lead, and in college football, when you can put eight up at a crack, you got to think about things like that. Ball's on the tee. The hold by Kingemi is there. The kick is up and through the uprights, and Van Horn continues to be perfect. Panthers lead at 34-10. There's a break in the third quarter action. We'll be right back.
This was for all that you do. You got the stuff to take it. You got the win.
19-yard field goal as the Panthers advance the ball 65 yards in 10 plays for the 3 points. And at 9:56 left third quarter, the Panthers extend their lead to 34-10 over the Mountaineers of West Virginia.
Outstanding movement on the last series. The rollout call with Kingemi, I'm not saying it bothered me, but I don't know if I wouldn't have gone at it straight ahead with the big boy a couple times. That was a percentage call. Maybe it was because West Virginia defensed it so well that I questioned it, and I don't like to second guess.
West Virginia really defensively did not play badly in the drive. If it wasn't for John Kingemi's 33-yard keeper on the scrambler out of the pocket on the blitz, it might have been a different story. But the Panthers did get down and get 3 points and now lead it 34-10.
And they haven't blitzed since. they flushed him out of the pocket. They have stayed vanilla all the way.
Panther kick return team is poised. Robert Bradley, the right alley. Nate Hayward, the left outside alley. Inside him, Zeke Gadsden, Lee Hetrick, Matt Lavinia. Here comes the kickoff by Mark Brasco. Darren Fulton deep to receive. Brasco kicks it high. And it's going to come down at about the six-yard line, looking into the sun as Fulton takes it at the 6, the 10, 15, 20, through the wedge. No, the Panthers got him. Good effort by Lee Hetrick. And Hetrick reached out and got the legs of Fulton as he went by. And instead of popping it and getting big yardage, he gets it out to the 26-yard line, where West Virginia will have a first and 10 at their own 27-yard line.
Interesting. They have given up on the double wedge. Now, what does that mean? Because they changed that return, do they feel like they're going to do a lot of returning? Good question.
That's a good question.
Why did they change the wedge?
It would take a coach to get into the head of another coach, I would think.
I
it's tough for broadcasters to do, I might caution you.
All righty.
First and 10, West Virginia from its own 27. Counter play to the left side. Hollyfield gets a block. Gets forward across the 30 to the 33-yard line, where Darrell Woods finally horse-collared him. But John Hollifield, the senior from Romulus, Michigan, at 5'11", 201, averaging almost 5 yards a carry, did a good job of sidestepping the initial tackler and turning this into about a 7-yard gain, second down three.
Shy of the 35.
Hollifield got 7 yards. We'll call it second down and a short three. Counter sweep to the left side. Travis Grant, and he turns up field. Grant is spelled. Travis Grant, where am I getting that? And he is tackled by Jerry Osofsky, the Panther linebacker, who came across the field in pursuit and got him at the 35 after a pickup of 1 yard.
Good play call, but excellent play by the middle linebacker, Osofsky. He read it, stayed at home, and come underneath, because if he had not made the play, they had the corner man turned out.
We call it third and a long one at the 35-yard line of West Virginia. Bert Grossman back in there at defensive end for the Panthers. 4 of 11, West Virginia on third down conversions. Hollifield turns the left side, is horse collared on a hard tackle by Billy Owens, but he gets the first down. Owens reached up across his pads and just dragged him backwards, and when his head hit the carpet, fortunately he's got that helmet going for him, because he just absolutely got his pins rolled back from underneath him. But he got the first down. After an advance of 2 yards out to the 37-yard line, almost to the 38. They're going to spot the football just shy of the 38-yard line. West Virginia first and 10. That is West Virginia's second first down in this, the second half. We have 8:29 left of the third quarter. Pitt well ahead 34-10. Harvey Smith is a flanker to one side, Grandis Bell to the other. Back to pass, Timko out of the backfield. Pass complete to Pecan. Pecan gets a block, turns it upfield, and gets the first down to the 49-yard line of Pitt. Diving for him was Walter Johnson initially. He couldn't stop the completion. Then Jerry Osofsky couldn't hold him back. And when Pecan, the fullback, turned it upfield, he got a first down. That play has worked for West Virginia about 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, they're running it underneath a double coverage. In other words, they put two men slotted right, run the men off, fake to the tailback, and drag the fullback underneath. And Osefsky's going to have to get underneath that, or they're going to throw it all night.
13 yards and a first down on the reception by Pecan. And now the turn and the give to Pecan, and he tries to come off the right side, and Pecan has no running room. He gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's all. Jerry Osofsky, Panther sophomore linebacker, 6'2", 212. Tony Mason, how about the play of Osofsky, the sophomore from Youngstown this year?
Boy, he's noticeable right now. I mean, all year he's done well, but they're taking him out. He's made 4 hits. He must be a little punchy, because he's been right in the middle of it all and doing a fine job. They must have put in a DB to go to a nickel.
Twin receivers out to the left side. West Virginia stacks them on a wide slot. Now they send the one man in motion. That is Keith Wynn, a tight end. Back is Timko. Sidesteps the rush. Here it comes from the backside. Pass is caught by Hollifield. Hollifield is hit and dropped, but he's got good yardage and a first down to the 38-yard line of Pitt. A one-handed catch by Hollifield, and we have a tackle at the 38-yard line. That marker down, holding against West Virginia. The gain will be nullified.
That's
marker back at the 46-yard line. Darrell Woods, Robert Bradley made the tackle, the hard hit on Hollifield, but the gain will go for naught. George Levy on B duty today, doing a great job.
That's it. That B has been over here too much, George. Handle that.
George, I just hope that the Humane Society is not listening, because I wouldn't want to get you in trouble, especially after you spent 13 hours at O'Hare yesterday. Anybody who spends 13 hours at O'Hare, it's almost like purgatory.
If that bee comes by me one more time, it would be Dumbo number 2 out the top window of our booth.
Play is marked back to the 41-yard line of West Virginia on the holding call. So West Virginia now facing a second and 20 at their own 41-yard line after the holding call. Timko back, plants, fires, complete far side with the football under Johnson. He's tackled immediately as he gets to the 46-yard line. Robert Bradley doing a good job as a Panther nickelback. Bradley, a redshirt freshman, and he's from down in Elizabeth, New Jersey, near Newark Airport at 5'10", 180 pounds.
Same play. Wide outs, one side of the field, drag the fullback underneath, and they have a nickelback in there to chase him now, which can close the gap a little quicker than a linebacker.
Five-yard gain sets up a third down and 15. West Virginia at its own 46. Timko is back. And he's got a pressure and a loose football, and here's a big pileup for it at the 42-yard line. Who has the football? Panthers are pointing in the direction of the other goal line, but referee John Sophie says, nope, West Virginia has fallen on the ball. I did not see, was it Tony Woods who stripped the football? What a play by Woods. And listen to the fans.
Defense played magnificently. They had a double rush. Woods was one of the men in there. I don't know if he was the man from the top side came in too.
West Virginia again has a drive killed by a big penalty. Now Lance Kerrion awaits the punt snap from John Stroya. Snap is true, not much of a rush, and he kicks a good tight spiral to the near sideline. It's going to go out of bounds at the 22-yard line of Pitt. So the Panthers will have it first and 10, and I see Chip Bukauskas is out now as the Panther center, along with Tom Ricketts, Bobby Sine, Mark Stepnoski, and Hosea Hurd and Michael Stewart will be receivers with Tinsley. As Osborne heads to the sideline and Kajemi takes the field. There's a break in the action. We'll be right back. The punt is ruled out of bounds at the 25-yard line in Pitt territory, so the Panthers will take over first and 10 at that point. And after a sideline conference, Chuck Scales comes in to take the place of Hosea Hurd as one of the Panther receivers. The official attendance this afternoon, we're short of a sellout. 55,129 is the official attendance, just a couple hundred short of sellout capacity here at Pitt Stadium. Mike Fox is in there as a defensive tackle for the West Virginia Mountaineers, seeing his first action of the day. And I guess both sides have to worry about keeping people fresh, because with the humidity at about 80%, now the sun breaking through and the temperature near 80 degrees with 30 pounds of equipment, that's a lot of adversity out there physically that these players have to face. Kajemi with a single setback steps in first and 10.